Jennings was a tough, buoyant little man, which was a good thing because he was seemingly disaster-prone. Almost killed when hit in the head by a pitch in 1897, he managed, a few years later, to dive into an empty swimming pool at Cornell and again fracture his skull. Still later, after coming to the Tigers, he was critically injured and a companion was killed when his automobile went off an ice-covered bridge near Scranton. In their talk at the hotel, Jennings tried to give Cobb some fatherly advice about holding his temper and putting the team's welfare before his own feelings. On the field, he knew that there was not much he could tell Cobb, who was, as the Detroit News' H.G. Salsinger put it, immersed in his own style. When Cobb wondered to Salsinger why Jennings paid no attention to him during the workouts, and Salsinger passed Cobb's concern along to the manager, Jennings told Cobb he was on his own at bat and on the bases. As Cobb phrased it a few years later, Jennings allowed me to seek my own salvation in my own way. Yet Cobb's troubles on the club were far from ended. When the team arrived at Warren Park on the afternoon of March 16th, Cobb was approached by the local groundskeeper, a black man nicknamed Bungie, whom he had known for 3 years. Cobb thought the groundskeeper had been drinking. In any case, the man stuck out his hand and, for some unexplained reason, called Cobb Carrie. Cobb's response was to push the man's hand away, and when he again came close, to slap him and chase him toward the clubhouse behind the third base bleachers. The groundskeeper's wife ran out of the clubhouse, which he had been cleaning, and began yelling at Cobb, who grabbed her and began to choke her. At that point, catcher Charlie Schmidt intervened and stopped Cobb from going any further. Schmidt, a burly ex-coal miner from Arkansas, who had once fought a short exhibition match against heavyweight boxing contender Jack Johnson, had come up the previous year with Davy Jones. One of the strongest men in baseball, Schmidt sometimes amused himself by pounding nails into wood with his fist, or lying on the floor and having his teammates trying futilely to pick him up. Though a Southerner himself, he had strong feelings against hurting women, black or white, and proceeded to tell the Georgian as much. "Whoever does a thing like that is a coward," Schmidt said, to which Cobb answered slowly, "I don't see as it interests you." Schmidt then hit Cobb with a glancing right. Cobb came back with a similarly ineffectual blow, and the two grappled until separated by other Tigers. The players berated Cobb and generally sided with the popular and usually good-natured catcher, while Jennings hopped around, furious with everyone, but most of all with Cobb, whom he thought he had straightened out. That night, Jennings wired Macon, where the Cleveland team was training. He offered a deal to Napoleon Larry Lajoie, the brilliant second baseman who had just missed winning the batting championship in 1906, his first year as Cleveland manager. Jennings wanted to make a straight trade, Cobb for outfielder Elmer Flick. That night, Jennings wired Macon, where the Cleveland team was training. He offered a deal to Napoleon Larry Lajoie, the brilliant second baseman who had just missed winning the batting championship in 1906, his first year as Cleveland manager. Jennings wanted to make a straight trade, Cobb for outfielder Elmer Flick. Flick had led the lead himself in 1905, had hit even better last year, but was now at odds with Lajoie and had not yet signed his contract. Meanwhile, Cobb told the reporters, "I'm in the right, and so long as I know that fact, I don't care what's done or said." The next day, Jennings announced that Lajoie, convinced Cobb was a troublemaker, wouldn't trade. Under no circumstances, added Jennings, would Cobb be sold. If he couldn't be traded for a first-rate ball player, then Cobb would stay with Detroit. 3 days later, Flick signed with Cleveland. An offer from New York manager Clark Griffith, whose team was training at Atlanta, of Frank Delahanty, an outfielder who had hit only .238 in part-time duty in 1906, didn't strike Jennings as a serious proposition. In later years, both Cobb and Frank Farrell, owner of the Highlanders, often had occasion to ponder how matters might have turned out if Cobb had relocated in the most lucrative and best-publicized baseball market in the country. Within 6 months, moreover, Larry LeJoie must have come to realize that not taking Cobb had probably cost his team the pennant that year. 4 days after the fight with Schmidt, Cobb played left field in the Tigers' first exhibition game against Augusta. Although he tripled, stole a base, and scored 3 times, he still impressed onlookers as being listless. Cobb complained that he had no friends on the team and said he wanted to play elsewhere. In Columbia, South Carolina, he cornered Jennings and demanded to be traded, sold, or released outright. The manager maintained that he was still talking to New York about Cobb. The next day, in Macon, Jennings said that Griffith still had offered nothing acceptable and that the negotiations with New York were off. President Charles Summers of Cleveland told the press that while he'd like to have Cobb, he wouldn't dare try to carry him on his team. Whether he liked it or not, Cobb seemed stuck with Detroit. At Columbia, Cobb got Jennings' permission to leave the team so he could return to Royston to pick up his mother and sister, who would then accompany him as the Tigers began their meandering journey toward Detroit. Whatever questions he may have had about the circumstances of his father's death, Cobb had never given any indication that he questioned his mother's integrity. Although he rarely mentioned her to acquaintances over the years, and referred to her only 3 times in his autobiography, his relationship with Amanda Cobb seems to have been warm and affectionate enough, though not extraordinarily so. Cobb's mother and his sister would live with Cobb in Detroit throughout the 1907 season. Paul Cobb, playing again that spring for Georgia Tech, also later came north for a tryout with Kalamazoo in the Southern Michigan League. Released after about a half season there, he ended the year playing semi-pro ball in California. Tyrus Cobb and his mother and sister met the Tigers in Atlanta, in time for Cobb to hit a home run against the local Southern League outfit. Then it was on to Meridian, Mississippi, and as it happened, a rematch with Charlie Schmidt. An article had appeared in an Atlanta newspaper suggesting that Cobb could whip Schmidt or anybody else on the Detroit club. Although the Georgian denied responsibility for the piece, Schmidt thought his pride was at stake and demanded satisfaction. Long afterward, Cobb maintained that while he was making his way onto the field at Meridian, Schmidt caught him off guard with a punch. Contemporary accounts held that the two fought only after agreeing to observe Marquess of Queensbury amenities. Everybody agreed, then and later, that the big catcher gave Cobb a thorough beating, breaking his nose and causing both eyes to swell nearly shut. After 1 round, Cobb had had enough. He forgot about the game with the Cotton States Leaguers and returned to the hotel, where his mother and sister cleaned him up and cared for his wounds. He was in no shape to play next day at Meridian or the day after that at Vicksburg. He finally reappeared in uniform for a game at Little Rock, singling and subsequently stealing home against a befuddled Southern League pitcher. By the time the Tigers backtracked to Birmingham for still another exhibition date, the Detroit writers traveling with them had managed to convince themselves that the second Cobb-Schmidt fracas had cleared the air, as honest, manly showdowns were always supposed to do. The whole atmosphere on the team had improved, they thought, and Cobb was now in better than at any time since he joined the Detroit club. Cobb, said Jennings, was too good a hitter to let get away, when a little diplomacy will get the boys together. Which, to the wider Red members of the press, might have suggested a rather Clausewitzian notion of diplomacy. Jennings' problem, as Paul Brusk stated it, was somehow to save for his club Tyrus Cobb, brilliant fielder, batsman, and base runner, but with a personality that baffles his teammates. To Huey Jennings' undying credit as a manager, he hit upon a workable solution to his outfield problems. Favoring Matty McIntyre, who finally signed his contract 2 days into the season, over Davy Jones, Jennings decided to put Cobb in right field and shift Sam Crawford to center. Crawford was no gazelle, and he had his own unhappiness with Cobb. In his autobiography, Cobb remembered still another bat-sawing incident in the 1907 season and blamed Crawford for instigating that particular petty vandalism. Yet if prideful and sometimes arrogant,
Crawford was also generally a professional, a man ultimately willing to subordinate personal feelings to team considerations. Thus, the blonde, broad-shouldered native of Wahoo, Nebraska, moved to center field, separating Cobb in right from McIntyre in left. It was a solution elegant in its simplicity. With that outfield alignment, and with Cobb hitting in fourth place behind Crawford, the Tigers opened the 1907 season on a cold gray day at Bennett Park before a crowd of 6,322, with a 2-0 win over Cleveland. Reliable George Mullen outpitching spitballer Glenn Liebhart. Cobb began the year auspiciously with two hits, a stolen base, and two runs scored. In the eighth inning, he executed the first of many demoralizing ventures that year against American League fielders, when he smashed a single past LaJoie at second base, stole second, continued to third when Nig Clark's throw skidded by LaJoie, and came home when center fielder Flick's backup throw got by third base. After the opener, though, Cobb was bothered by a cold for some time and played sluggishly. He was hitting only .247 after 19 games. Meanwhile, Huey Jennings' antics on the coaching lines hyped players and rooters and helped make him one of the most memorable managers in baseball history. Unlike the natty and reserved Bill Armour, who had remained on the bench in street clothes, Jennings coached in uniform at first or third, stamping his feet, clawing up hands full of grass, and yelling his ear-splitting, "Yah!" About two-thirds of the way through that season, his voice gave out, and he resorted to blowing a whistle to convey his signals to the Tigers. The umpires and Van Johnson objected to the whistle, and when Jennings refused to give it up, Johnson suspended him for 2 weeks. He came back, sans whistle, but with voice restored. If Tyrus Cobb, or Ty, as he was now almost invariably called, would never be entirely reconciled with his early teammates, at least under Jennings, the lingering animosities among the Detroit players no longer interfered with their play. As far as Cobb's situation was concerned, it helped when McIntyre broke his ankle, sliding into second early in May, and was out for the year. Davy Jones took over left field and the leadoff position and went on to have a solid season. Even with McIntyre gone, Jennings kept Cobb in right. And there, on the bases and eventually at bat, Cobb's performance in 1907 was consistently spectacular. By early June, he had pushed his average well above .300. Crawford was also hitting well, and the team was battling with Chicago and Cleveland for the league lead. 5 weeks later, Cobb became the first player in either league that season to make 100 hits, a feat that brought a contingent of Bennett Park Detroit rooters rushing onto the field to give him a diamond-studded watch fob. He hit left-handers that year at a .378 clip, although he still usually had trouble with Chicago's Nick Altrock, whose clowning on and off the field never interfered with his pitching prowess. If Cobb's base running was often, as one observer described it, daring to the point of dementia, it was also successful more times than not. He left everybody stunned at Hilltop Park in New York when he crossed up Highlander first baseman Hal Chase, who, though only in his third big league season, was already widely regarded as the most skilled man ever to play the position. After taking a throw at first with a runner advancing to third, Chase liked to snap the ball over to the third baseman, and if not catch the runner off, at least drive him back to the bag. On June 11th, in the ninth inning with the Tigers way ahead, Cobb doubled, and instead of stopping at third on Claude Rossman's bunt, roared around the base and came home, as Chase, first intending to throw behind Cobb, and then trying to stop his motion and peg home, sent the ball flying over third baseman George Moriarty's head. It was maybe the graceful Chase's most embarrassing moment on the diamond in 15 years in the majors. Later in the season, Cobb similarly embarrassed Moriarty, tearing home and scoring when Moriarty held the ball, unable to decide what to do with it. Again and again, Cobb acted on his theory that the advantage was his when he made fielders throw the ball, and on his passionate conviction that the base paths and bases belonged to him. As an example, In a lopsided victory over Cleveland at Bennett late in June, he tripled to the scoreboard in left center to drive in Crawford and kept going around third as third baseman Bill Bradley relayed the throw home. Catcher Harry Bemis had the ball waiting, but Cobb, with a head-first lunge, got a shoulder into Bemis, knocked him over, and made him drop the ball. Enraged, Bemis grabbed the ball and pounded the prostrate Cobb on the head with it, until pulled away by Jones and umpire Silk O'Loughlin. Jennings shoved Cobb toward the bench as O'Loughlin threw Bemis out of the game. Subsequently, Cobb beat out a bunt, doubled in another run, and stole third. One stratagem Cobb made almost uniquely his own. Over the winter, the club had purchased first baseman Claude Rossman from Cleveland for $2,500. Slow-footed, cantankerous, and with a penchant for erratic throws that would ultimately send him back to the minors, the lanky Rossman was nonetheless a reliable hitter and an outstanding sacrifice bunter, better at that particular maneuver even than Cobb. Hitting in front of Rossman, Cobb early learned to take advantage of Rossman's bunting skills. Confident that Rossman would be able to drop the ball where the third baseman had to come in for it, Cobb would flash the bunt sign, take off from first with the pitcher's motion, and head for third as the third baseman fielded the ball, threw to first, and then scrambled back to cover his base. Most of the time, he slid in safely. Cobb and Rossman repeatedly executed that play until Rossman left the Tigers in 1909. Cobb would continue to go from first to third on bunts, as well as other infield outs, for years after that. But the play was never so consistently effective as when he worked it with Rossman. In a period before statisticians gave runs batted in crucial significance, Cobb considered his main value offensively to be a matter of getting on base and scoring runs. On June 29th, against Cleveland, he scored 4 runs for the first time in his career, in the same game in which Harry Bemis tried to beat him senseless with the ball. Characteristically, Cobb's scoring was involved with his ability to steal bases. On July 16th, he made his first steal of home in the majors, off Philadelphia's Rube Waddell. 2 days later, against Washington, he first stole 3 bases in a game, and on October 2nd, he had 4 steals, again versus Washington. Meanwhile, his fielding, often shaky in 1905 and 1906, improved steadily and sometimes was sensational. Playing a shallow right field, he had 30 assists, more than in any other year he was in the majors. While most came on runners thrown out at second, third, or home, several times Cobb doubled runners off bases, and on a few occasions, he threw out slow-moving opponents at first after fielding 1-bounce liners. On August 2nd, Detroit beat Washington a doubleheader at American League Park in the Capitol and took the league lead for the first time that year. The major significance of the date, however, turned out to be that it marked the major league debut of a gangly 19-year-old pitcher with remarkably long arms, brought up directly from Idaho semi-pro ball, named Walter Johnson. In facing Johnson that day, Cobb later said, "I encountered the most threatening sight I ever saw on a ball field." As the rookie right-hander took his windup and came around with an easy sidearm motion, Cobb barely saw the ball. The thing just hissed with danger, he thought. Not only was Johnson by far the fastest pitcher Cobb had ever met, he soon demonstrated that he had nearly pinpoint control, most extraordinary in a raw rookie. His first time at bat, Cobb was able to lay down a bunt that the awkward newcomer could not field. Then he went from first to third on Rossman's bunt single and scored on a fly ball. After Washington tied the game in the 6th inning, Crawford hit to the scoreboard in distant left field for a home run. Meanwhile, Cobb threw out a runner at home and another at first. Johnson left for a pinch hitter in the 9th after giving up 7 hits and striking out 3, with the score 3-1, Detroit. That inning, Cobb misplayed a single into a 2-base error and let in a run, but Washington's rally fell a run short. Although Walter Johnson took the loss in his first major league appearance, Cobb and the rest of the Tigers knew we'd met the most powerful arm ever turned loose in a ballpark. Cobb later claimed that because of his knowledge of phrenology, he could read Johnson's features and tell that he was kindly and even-tempered, and thus could take advantage of him by crowding the plate. Johnson, afraid of hitting somebody with his deadly fastball, would not drive Cobb back as other pitchers did. Whether or not that was the secret of his success, Cobb did hit Johnson consistently over the 21 years the two faced each other. In 67 games, far more than Cobb played against any other pitcher, Cobb compiled a .335 average. By mid-August, Chicago and Cleveland were gradually slipping back in the pennant race. But Connie Mack's Philadelphia Athletics had come on to battle Detroit for first. After losing 2 of 3 games at Philadelphia, the Tigers still led by half a game when they came home for another 3 games with the Athletics. It was a new experience to be greeted by hundreds of partisans at the railroad station and cheered by others gathered on street corners as the team rode a trolley into the business district. An exultant William Yawkey had his tailor fit each man on the team with a new suit of clothes. On August 12th, with Yawkey and Navin having bought the planing mill property behind center field and moved the fences back to accommodate more standees, some 11,500 turned out at Bennett Park to see the Athletics batter Killian and Seaver and win 7-3 behind Waddell. Cobb singled and doubled in the losing effort and made one of his now typical dashes from first to third on a Rossman bunt, knocking down shortstop Simon Nichols on his way. The next day, Eddie Plank struck out Cobb 3 times and handled the other Tigers easily as well, 3-0. The Tigers got back to within half a game of first in the series finale, knocking out Waddell and winning 9-2 behind Donovan. Cobb had 3 singles and a double, scored all the way from second on Jimmy Diggert's wild pitch, and doubled a runner off first after taking a liner. Detroit then lost 2 straight to New York before trouncing the Highlanders 13-6 in front of 9,635 in the first Sunday game ever played at Bennett Park. Detroit's mayor and police chief, as well as Wayne County Sheriff James D. Burns, himself a former owner of the Tigers, all cheerfully acquiesced in this flouting of state and city Sabbath laws. It was a game in which the Tigers ran the bases freely, Germany Schaefer even scoring from second on a bunt by Cobb. Detroit and Philadelphia stayed at the top of the league for the next month, with the White Sox and the Naps, as Cleveland's rooters had now dubbed Napoleon Lajoie's team, always within striking distance. Cobb played furiously, and seemingly without regard for personal well-being. His sliding scrapes became open running sores that agonized him whenever he hit sun-baked and hardened infield ground. He finally had to seek medical attention in Cleveland, and never forgave Frank Navin for refusing to pay the bill. On that same stay in Cleveland, Cobb leaped the ropes holding back an overflow crowd in right to make a catch, landed on a broken pop bottle, and badly cut his right hand. After getting the hand wrapped, he stayed in the game, but later tore it open sliding. At St. Louis, hitting with bandaged hand, he got only 3 hits in 5 games, 2 of which were a doubleheader loss that again knocked Detroit out at first. When a pop bottle hurled by a spectator knocked umpire Billy Evans unconscious in that series, baseball writers in various cities called for a ban on bottles inside parks, a plea that would go unanswered for several more decades. On Monday, September 10th, his hand infected by now, Cobb missed his first game of the year at Chicago. He was back in the lineup the next day, though, removing the bandage and then getting 2 hits, driving in 2 runs, stealing 2 bases, and scoring twice. One time when he came all the way around from first on a single in a 9-1 Tiger victory. When Cobb's hell-bent style drew charges from people like Horace S. Vogel of the Philadelphia Bulletin that he was a dirty player, his defenders came back that he only played the game hard and to win. In September, B.F. Wright, in his regular column from Detroit for the Sporting News, insisted that not once during the year had an umpire heard the sound of his voice in protest, and that now Cobb was highly esteemed by all his team associates. Said Ed Killian, one of his former tormentors, Let Ty get on first, and all he's got to do is keep running. The other fellows don't know what to do with the ball. Though not quite ready to put local patriotism aside, the respected New York writer Joe Vila was willing to call Cobb the best all-around ball player in the country today, barring Hal Chase. And by late in the season, Cobb's notoriety had become such that he had made his first commercial endorsement of Coca-Cola, a product with which he was to have a long and exceedingly lucrative association. At the end of September, what the New York Times called the greatest struggle in the history of baseball had entered its final week. On Friday, September 27th, the Tigers, leading by only 8 percentage points, opened a decisive three-game series in Philadelphia. Though giving up 13 hits, Bill Donovan won the series opener 5-4 over Eddie Plank. Back in Detroit, hundreds of people stood in the rain before outdoor scoreboards that provided running accounts of the contest off the wire services. The Saturday game was rained out, so a sellout crowd had to go home to wait through Sunday, when baseball was illegal everywhere in Pennsylvania, for a doubleheader on Monday. That day, more than 24,000 bought tickets to get into Columbia Park, so named because it was located at 29th Street and Columbia Avenue. The park had seats for about 15,000, so the surplus ticket holders crowded up against the foul lines, ringed the outfield, and even sat atop the fences. Although the arrangements were hardly optimum for two games that would probably determine the pennant, the congested, confused scene at Columbia Park on September 30th, 1907, was a common enough one in those days. The first game of the doubleheader turned out to be the only one played. After 17 innings, with the teams tied at 9-9, it was too dark to continue. The game was an epic encounter, the one singled out by Cobb as the most thrilling he ever played in. Donovan, with 2 days' rest, started against the little spitballer, Jimmy Diggert. The Athletics hit Donovan freely in the early innings and led 7-1 after 6. Much of the damage resulted from a fly ball near the crowd dropped by Davy Jones, who thereby brought down upon himself the wrath of his keyed-up teammates when he got back to the bench. In the second inning, Connie Mack sent in Rube Waddell to relieve Diggert after Diggert made 2 errors to let in a run. The fun-loving, beer-guzzling Waddell, one of the supremely talented men ever to take the mound, fired his fastball past the Tigers for 4 more innings. In the top of the 7th, however, the Tigers got 4 runs in a rally highlighted by Crawford's 2-run ground rule double into the outfield overflow. Philadelphia scored another in the bottom half of the inning. The Tigers matched that in the 8th to make the score 8-6. Then Crawford opened the 9th by singling. Cobb rose to the occasion, lifting the left-hander's second pitch, a curveball, over the right field fence and into 29th Street to tie the game. Cobb's 4th and next-to-last home run of the year knocked Waddell out of the game and, according to legend, caused the dignified Mack to fall off the Athletics bench and into a pile of bats. Eddie Plank took over from the battered Rube and retired the side. Donovan grew stronger the longer he pitched. The Tigers went ahead in the top of the 10th, and although Philadelphia again tied the score in the bottom of the inning, neither pitcher was in trouble after that. Not until the bottom of the 14th, when first baseman Harry Davis of the Athletics hit a fly into center field, Crawford moved back to the roped-in crowd and got ready to make the catch, only to have one policeman on duty jump in front of him and another jostle his arm and make him drop the ball. Jennings, Crawford, and the rest of the Tigers stormed around the umpires, 2 were on duty, and demanded an interference call. Plate umpire O'Loughlin deferred to Tom Connolly, working the bases, who ruled Davis out on interference. The milling and arguing went on for many minutes, during which first Donovan and then Rossman traded pushes and punches with Waddell, now in street clothes, and utility infielder Monty Cross. Still another policeman arrested Rossman and took him out of the park. Finally, the crowd was pushed back. The players resumed their positions, with Killian going to first for Detroit, and Donovan pitched to Danny Murphy, who hit a clean single that would easily have scored Davis from second with a winning run. Donovan got out of the inning unscathed, however, and the game went on scorelessly until the people in the grandstand could barely see the outfielders, and the umpires called it after 17. As one observer said, players and spectators alike were simply exhausted by the terrific nervous strain. All told, Cobb had a single, a double, and a home run in 8 times up, as well as a stolen base and 2 runs scored. The win and tie in Philadelphia left the Tigers with too much of a lead for Mack's team to overcome. Detroit went to Washington and swept 4 games, in one of which Cobb stole 4 bases. He had 13 hits at 18 at-bats against Washington before he collapsed near home plate during a rundown in the last game. Third baseman Jim Delahanty first dropped the ball in the chase and then retrieved it and tagged Cobb as he lay 2 yards from home, too exhausted to get up or even crawl. It had been a long season and a tough way to make $2,400. The next day, the Athletics, after winning twice from Cleveland, lost to Walter Johnson in 10 innings at Washington. Meanwhile, at St. Louis, about 12,000 people turned out on a Saturday to watch the Tigers give Detroit its first Major League championship since the 1887 pennant, won by Sam Thompson, Charlie Bennett et al., in the old National League. After Ed Seaver beat the Browns 10-2, with Cobb leading the attack by tripling in Jones, and later hitting one over the trees beyond the right field fence, again with Jones aboard, the St. Louis fans surrounded the Tigers and cheered them to their horse-drawn bus. On Sunday, as Cobb and various other regulars sat out a meaningless doubleheader loss to the Browns, thousands took to the streets in and around Detroit to celebrate. Besides cavorting in old baseball uniforms and a variety of other regalia, quite a few Detroiters painted black tiger stripes on yellowish dogs and paraded with the unhappy canines. That night, festive bonfires lighted up Detroit, as well as neighboring towns like Highland Park, River Rouge, and Hamtramck. The sixth-place Tigers in 1906 won the 1907 pennant, with a record of 92-58 to 88-57 for Philadelphia. 4 sturdy pitchers accounted for all but 4 of the wins. Donovan, 26. Killian, 24. Mullen, 21. And Seaver, 17. At the age of 20 years and 10 months, Cobb became the youngest man ever to win the big league batting championship. His final game hits gave him 212 for the year and pushed his average to 350. Crawford was batting runner-up at 323, his best showing since 1903. Cobb's 5 home runs were second to Harry Davis's 8. And while statisticians paid little attention to runs batted in during that period, it would interest later generations that Cobb led the league with 116. He also led in stolen bases with 49, and was third behind Crawford and Jones in runs scored. The Detroit team batting average, 266, was a high one for those years, and topped both major leagues. At season's end, Paul Brusk, writing from Detroit in Sporting Life, got carried away and declared that Cobb had won his battle over the hostility of his teammates, who now mainly credited him with the club's success, and would take his loss as a genuine calamity and a personal bereavement as well. In fact, Cobb remained basically a loner, edgy and uneasy around his teammates, as generally they still were around him. In none of the photographs from that period of his life is he caught smiling. Moreover, if one puts any stock in the theory of body language, then there may be some significance in the way Cobb looks in the 1907 Detroit team picture. Whereas on either side of him, third baseman Bill Coughlin and utility man Jerry Downs sit with legs apart and with knees and hands touching the shoulders of, respectively, Huey Jennings and reserve catcher Jimmy Archer, Cobb sits with legs together and extended, with elbows tucked against his body, and with hands gripping his glove, as if trying not to touch or be touched. As has often been the case following a torrid pennant race, the World Series of 1907 was something of an anticlimax. Against the Chicago Cubs, the tired Tigers were simply overmatched. just as the whole National League had been in 1906 and 1907. In the Cubs of first baseman manager Frank Chance, Cobb and his teammates came up against one of the great outfits in baseball history. It was a team that had won an all-time major league record 116 games in 1906, before astonishingly losing to the crosstown White Sox 4-2 in the series. In 1907, the Cubs won 107 and finished 17 games in front of second place Pittsburgh. With five strong pitchers and a staff earned run average of 173, the Cubs also had clutch hitting and a tight defense, featuring the brilliant catching of Johnny Kling and the fabled double play combination of shortstop Joe Tinker and second baseman Johnny Evers. On October 8th, in the series opener, 24,337 packed and slightly overflowed the Cubs' West Side grounds at Polk and Lincoln, later Walcott Streets. It was the biggest crowd in series history up to that time. As Cobb approached the plate for his first at-bat, umpire Hank O'Day stopped play, so a representative of a St. Louis jewelry company could present an ornate diamond-studded medal, the prize the company had put up for the batting champion in each league. Cobb then grounded meekly to Frank Chance. After that, Bill Donovan battled the Cubs' Orville Overall and Ed Reulbach to a 12-inning 3-3 tie, made possible when Charlie Schmidt's passed ball on a called third strike let in the tying run in the ninth. Cobb went hitless and had a sacrifice bunt in four times up. A 4-game rout by the Cubs followed. Chicago base runners had stolen at will in the first game tie off Schmidt, who was trying to catch with a broken bone in his throwing hand. In the next four games, they continued to run with little hindrance from Schmidt, Fred Payne, and finally Jimmy Archer, and ended up with a total of 18 steals for the series. Afterward, Johnny Evers thought that the inability of Detroit's pitchers to keep runners from taking big leads had been the main factor in the Cubs' base-running carnival. Overall, Reulbach, lefty Jake Feaster, and Mordecai Brown held the Tigers to an average of less than a run in each of the four games that counted. Detroit's team batting average for the whole series was a little above 200. Feaster outpitched Mullen in the second game, also at Chicago, 3-1. At Detroit on October 10th, Reulbach overcame Seaver and Killian 4-1. The next day, also at Detroit, Overall did the same to Mullen 6-1. And on the 12th, only 7,370 people showed up at Bennett Park to see Brown end it by shutting out the Tigers 2-0, with Mullen pitching well but taking his third loss. Yet even after that, the Detroit rooters went into the streets again to celebrate the fact that their team had made it into a World Series. Their post-game enthusiasm failed to impress I.F. Sanborn of the Chicago Tribune, who believed that the poor attendance in Detroit proved that a city of that size will not stand for a loser. Sanborn expected the disappearance of Detroit from the major league map within a few years. Cobb managed 4 hits and 20 official at-bats over the 5 games. He had a single off Feaster in Game 2, another single off Reulbach in Game 3, and a triple into the crowd in center field off Overall to score Schaefer in Game 4. In the finale, he stretched a liner to right center into a double off Brown, but then was cut down trying to steal third by the strong-armed Kling. The wonderful Ty Cobb, wrote Joe Vila, dwindled from a world beater to a lame amateur. The money they made from getting into the series did a lot to assuage the chastened spirits of Cobb and the other Tigers. Helping to swell their shares was the fact that the owners had agreed beforehand to count receipts from any tie games in figuring the players' pot. Jennings and 19 Tiger players, including McIntyre, split nearly $22,000, allocated by the National Commission, plus $15,000, the club owner's share, which President Yawkey generously decided his team ought to have. Thus, each Tiger came out with $1,946, which in Cobb's case was only $454 less than his whole season's pay that year. It was quite a dividend for a 20-year-old, only 2 years from the lowest minors. Enough to pay off whatever remaining debts the family may have had, with quite a bit left over for extras. Well might Yawkey and also Frank Navin be generous, because the Tigers' home attendance had soared to nearly 300,000. Although that was still seventh in the American League, more only than last place Washington, it was enough to give the Detroit club a substantial surplus. Navin took his share of the profits, about $50,000, and paid back what Yawkey had lent him the previous year to buy a half interest in the franchise. Over the winter, moreover, Yawkey stepped down as president in favor of Navin, although until his death in 1919, Yawkey would continue to be a major stockholder in the club. At a goodbye banquet given for the team by Yawkey at the Hotel Cadillac, B.F. Wright paraphrased Ernest R. Thayer's famous poem with something called Ty Cobb at the Bat, before Cobb was awarded his batting title medal a second time. The young Georgian responded with appropriate modesty, saying that he deserved no more credit than anybody else on the team. Then the next day, he went to Chicago with most of the other Tigers to begin a series of exhibition games with the Cubs there and at various places near Chicago, with the players to split all the receipts. Hampered by bad weather, the World Series opponents drew poorly. After appearing in only 2 games and picking up about $100, Cobb headed for Royston with his mother and sister. At home, his admirers were waiting with a handsome gold pocket watch for the local boy who had indubitably made good. The perquisites of fame were starting to come fast. 5. Two more pennants and October disappointments. Cobb left Detroit with more money than he had ever had, but he intended to make a lot more. The New York American was right on target in describing him as having acquired, above all, a superbly insolent confidence in himself. Cobb was good, and he was perfectly aware of that fact. He also understood that within 2 seasons, his rabid way of playing the game had made him probably the top gate attraction in the American League. That off-season, he made up his mind that he would never again simply accept what his club was willing to give him, as he had done for the previous 2 years. There was also a new reason for Cobb to want to put himself on solid ground financially. Not long before his 21st birthday, he wrote the Detroit Times' Paul Brusk a peppery message, reporting his engagement to a young lady from Augusta, named, it later became known, Charlie Marion Lombard. She was the daughter of Roswell Lombard, a well-to-do Augusta businessman who owned a downtown theater, an interest in his brother George's iron and steel works, and various other properties in and around Augusta. He also owned an estate called The Oaks, out in the country south of the city. Even though the Lombards belonged to the Methodist Episcopal Church south, they sent their daughter to nearby St. Mary's Convent to be educated. She may have met Cobb as early as 1905, when he was playing for Augusta, and she was only 14. Cobb began courting her seriously over the winter of 1906 through 7. He probably had to work at breaking down the common prejudice among genteel folk against ball players and theater people. Whatever difficulties he may have encountered were evidently overcome by late 1907. Cobb and Charlie Lombard intended to marry during the coming year, although he told acquaintances that it would not be that spring. Possibly, her parents insisted that they wait at least until after the girl's 17th birthday. Early in the new year, Frank Navin sent Cobb his 1908 contract, which provided for a flat $3,000. Alluding to the economic downturn that had hit the country the previous year, Navin maintained that prospects are not very bright for next year, and that the increase is as large as possible. Cobb sent the document right back unsigned, then made public his own terms. A 3-year contract at $5,000 per year. Personal exemption from the rule whereby a club could release a ball player outright with only 10 days' notice, and compensation in full in case he were incapacitated through sickness or injury. If he didn't get his term, said Cobb, then he might play with the powerful Logan Squares semi-pro team in Chicago, or maybe sign with a new professional league called the Union Association, just then being formed. The owners had had it all their way, he complained, and they continue to oppress ball players. He was only contending for what I consider my rights, after 2 years of good ball at a low salary. Cobb sent the document right back unsigned, then made public his own terms. A 3-year contract at $5,000 per year. Personal exemption from the rule whereby a club could release a ball player outright with only 10 days' notice. And compensation in full in case he were incapacitated through sickness or injury. If he didn't get his term, said Cobb, then he might play with a powerful Logan Squares semi-pro team in Chicago, or maybe sign with a new professional league called the Urban Association, just then being formed. The owners had had it all their way, he complained, and they continue to oppress ball players. He was only contending for what I consider my rights after 2 years of good ball at a low salary. The war of words that ensued was the first of two major salary battles Cobb and Navin would have. Of course, the confrontation came more than 65 years before the advent of free agency and arbitration procedures in baseball. In Cobb's time, players were absolutely bound to their clubs by the reserve clause. If they objected to the terms offered them, their only recourse was to hold out, in which case they might be traded, released, or eventually, if they still refused to sign, ostracized within organized baseball. Cobb knew full well the power baseball law gave Navin, knew the chance he was taking with his future in the game. At one point, he later claimed, he and his family were so fed up with the whole acrimonious process that he seriously thought about quitting baseball and going to college with the goal of entering law or medicine, as his father had wanted him to do. Cobb and Navin issued threats and counter-threats, claims and counterclaims. Navin declared that McIntyre, healthy again, Jones and Crawford would still be the best outfield in the league. Besides, to allow Cobb to bluff us into giving his case different treatment would be to court a holdup on the part of every other player. Crawford had already signed for $4,000, and practically all the other Tigers had settled amicably. Why couldn't Cobb? Generally, the Detroit press backed Navin, reasoning that Cobb had done well financially for one so young, and should be satisfied with as much pay as many 10-year veterans were getting. Cobb's salary demand, said Huey Jennings, was absurd on its face. His teammates, Germany Schaefer and Charlie O'Leary, in their touring vaudeville act, suggested the sentiments of many baseball followers in Detroit and elsewhere with one of their dreadful puns. Why does Tyrus Cobb Tyrus? At home, the Augusta Chronicle solidly backed Cobb. When, in mid-March, the Georgian accepted Navin's invitation to come to Detroit for some man-to-man talk about his contract, Chronicle sports editor Thomas Hamilton warned of a double cross. The Lord help him up north, prayed Hamilton. Actually, Cobb, wary as he had become, and stubborn as he had always been, was quite capable of taking care of himself. On March 20th, Cobb and Navin met inconclusively for 3 hours. It isn't a question of principle with me, he told the press afterward. I want the money. He also admitted, though, that he was crazy to play ball. That afternoon, he received visits from George P. Codd, who until recently had been Detroit's mayor, and Fielding H. Yost, the renowned football coach at the University of Michigan, both of whom urged him to try once more with Navin. That he did after dinner, this time dropping his special clause demands and finally agreeing to a 1-year contract at $4,000, with a bonus of $800 to be paid if he hit 300 again. Cobb announced that he was satisfied and would shortly report to Little Rock, Arkansas for spring training with the Tigers, but only after he had tended to his affairs in Georgia. Cobb left Royston on March 24th, and after detouring to Augusta to see his fiancée, and then up into North Carolina for a visit with his Cobb grandparents, finally headed for the Tiger training camp. This time, his mother and sister would make the trip to Detroit on their own. As in 1907, they would live with Cobb in an apartment in a fashionable residential section out on Woodward Avenue, where, among other new effects, he installed a player piano. He had also bought his first automobile, a sporty Chalmers two-seater, and begun to indulge a taste for expensive clothes and good cigars. Meanwhile, Paul Cobb, back from California, prepared to join the Joplin, Missouri team in the Class C Western Association. Built along the same lines as his older brother, but an inch or so shorter, and a right-handed hitter as well as thrower, Paul Cobb would enjoy a good season in 1908 at Joplin, and later Enid, Oklahoma. In a league dominated by tough pitching, he would hit a respectable .273, with 10 homers and 34 stolen bases, and would be drafted by the St. Louis Browns. When he got to Little Rock at the end of March, Ty Cobb again aired his unhappiness with a system under which a ball player, even if he had good years, hasn't the chance of a rabbit unless public opinion is with him. The league has him just where it wants him, and it isn't going to pay him any more money than it has to. What ought to be done, he said, was to limit the term of the reserve clause to 5 years, after which a player would be absolutely free to go to whatever club offered him the most. To the poorly paid sports writers who patiently took down and reported Cobb's pronouncements, such an idea must have seemed interesting but hopelessly unrealistic. The suddenly affluent young man might be a wizard on the playing field, but he would be better off leaving the business of baseball to the baseball businessmen. As Cobb would demonstrate annually for many years, reporting late for spring training was no handicap to a man who stayed in shape year-round, whether he was 21 or 41. 3 days after arriving at Little Rock, he played against the city's Southern League team, banged out 2 hits, and stole a base. It was in that game that he got his first look at a young center fielder from Texas, who would hit .350 with Little Rock that year, come up to Boston at season's end, and go on to become Cobb's chief rival for all-around stardom in the American League. His name was Tris Speaker. Although Cobb soon caught a cold at Little Rock and had to go to bed, he was in fine form by April 14th, when Detroit opened the season at Southside Park in Chicago before nearly 20,000. Besides singling twice off Doc White, he drove Nick Altrock's curve into the right field bleachers and received a shower of gifts from Chicago merchants for hitting their year's first home run. With 5 errors behind Seaver and Willett, however, the Tigers lost 15-5. 3 days later, they opened at home in Bennett Park, which, after a refurbishing and enlargement directed by Navin over the winter, now seated some 10,500. Navin's official attendance count that day was 14,051, a new Detroit record. Cobb was 3-for-6, and drove in 2 runs in another loss, 9-3, to Cleveland in 12 innings. Unlike the previous spring, Cobb got off to an excellent start in 1908. By mid-May, he was hitting .365, and on his second trip to Chicago, the local rooters presented him with a Silver Loving Cup for being the most popular visiting player. On May 2nd, he passed a personal landmark when, after being called out by Silk O'Loughlin trying to stretch a triple into a home run against the White Sox at Bennett, he protested so obstreperously that O'Loughlin threw him out of the game, his first ejection in the big leagues. The team, by contrast, started poorly, losing 9 of its first 12 games. But then the Tigers got hot on their initial Eastern trip, won 9 straight, and came back home to move into first with a Memorial Day doubleheader sweep of the White Sox. After that, they again slumped somewhat. But by midsummer, Detroit was locked in a 4-way battle for the pennant with Cleveland, Chicago, and the surprising St. Louis Browns, for whom Rube Waddell, sold by Connie Mack in the offseason, was having his last good year. Despite his contract demands, and the fact that after only 2 full seasons in the league, he was making more money than anybody in the club except Crawford and possibly Donovan, Cobb appeared to be getting along with the other Tigers better than at any time since he came up in 1905. Paul Brusk proclaimed Cobb to be a grown man now, accepted at his own rating by all his mates. A person who actually accepts advice. If Cobb's relationships with his teammates never became comradely, at least by the 1908 season, his worst days were behind him. Even Cobb and McIntyre, once again the team's regular left fielder and leadoff man, were able to be around each other without bristling, although Jennings wisely kept Crawford playing between them. Long afterward, Cobb maintained that at the time of McIntyre's death in 1920, he had still never once shaken his hand. According to a contemporary account, however, Cobb and McIntyre shook hands and pledged to put aside their two-year quarrel as the team waited on the Detroit station platform for the train to Chicago on the night of June 27th. The precipitant in bringing them together supposedly had been Cobb's ejection by Tom Connelly that afternoon, after he ran up from the bench to protest a strike Connelly had just called on McIntyre. Better feelings between Cobb and the rest of the team hardly dampened his fiery spirits on the field. He later claimed that it was not until 1908 that I felt for the first time the positive conviction that baseball was the career for me. Sure of his own abilities, increasingly aware of the weaknesses of his adversaries, he played with a fierceness that must often have seemed demonic to those who had to contend against him. Fully cognizant of the reputation he was making for himself, Cobb was willing for the image to outgrow the reality. It served his purposes, for example, if opposing basemen really believed that he regularly sharpened his spikes. That particular allegation stemmed from an episode in New York in 1908, when a couple of Tiger bench warmers, deciding they would try to scare or at least confuse the Highlanders, sat on the bench, filing their spikes, as the New York players trooped by on their way to the field. By the time various local sports writers got through, they had Cobb himself doing the sinister work with mouth twisted and eyes ablaze. That yarn became the most durable item in the vast amount of Cobbian folklore accumulating over the decades. At least as far as his public statements were concerned, Cobb let it stand until well after his retirement. The reality of Ty Cobb, though, was fearsome enough. Insisting that the base paths and bases were his, he often came in hard and with spikes high, and over the years, he cut numerous opponents. Cobb deliberately undertook to become what a later generation of sports jargonists would call an intimidator. His reputation for ruthlessness, combined with his speed and lightning-quick perception, forced opposing players into numerous mistakes, and generally gave him an edge that he exploited relentlessly. And if crowds in opponents' ballparks became menacing, as they did in Boston in mid-July, when Cobb got tangled up with shortstop Heinie Wagner after he was caught stealing at second, he seemed to thrive on their hostility. In that particular game, Cobb singled twice, tripled, and after his mix-up with Wagner, iced a 6-3 Detroit win in 10 innings with a home run into deep right center field. As he dusted himself off and trotted back to the Tiger bench, Cobb showed his contempt for the angry Bostonians by gesturing for them to sit down and shut up. Cobb also remained quick-tempered with people off the field who crossed him, especially if they happened to be black. Sprinkled along through Cobb's years in baseball were a variety of incidents in which he took violent offense at some black person's behavior. The fracas with the Augusta groundskeeper and his wife during spring training in 1907 was only the first such incident. In simplest terms, Cobb was what, 50 years later, people would freely call a racist. Which is to say that he believed blacks to be fundamentally different from and inferior to whites, and thus necessarily suited to a subservient role in a society that must be dominated by whites. Although most non-Southern whites probably felt basically the same way, that belief was most prevalent among white people in the Southern states, where the overwhelming majority of blacks still lived, and where fear of racial change was most acute. Yet if the doctrine of white supremacy was nearly universal within the white South, obviously the degree of intensity with which it was held would vary from person to person. Cobb's racial feelings appear to have been quite strong indeed. He had pleasant recollections of a black maid who had looked after the Cobb children at their home in Royston. And he was capable of acts of kindness toward particular black persons. But he had no patience whatever with blacks who were insolent, fractious, unsubmissive, in a word, uppity. In the somewhat less constrained racial climate of Detroit and the other northern cities where Cobb played, he repeatedly had to deal with blacks who withheld the automatic deference a white man was accustomed to in the South. An episode in Detroit, early in June 1908, would be of no great consequence, except that it illustrates the problem Cobb often had. Leaving the Hotel Pontchartrain and starting to cross Woodward Avenue, he stepped into some asphalt just put down by city workers. A black laborer named Fred Collins yelled angrily for him to get out of the area. Cobb took offense, and after an exchange of words, knocked Collins down, then continued on his way. On a Monday morning 2 days later, Cobb had to appear in municipal court before Judge Edward Jeffries on an assault and battery charge brought by Collins. Claiming that the Negro had insulted and provoked him, Cobb pleaded not guilty. Jeffries found that Cobb had assaulted Collins, then suspended his sentence, and thereby won Cobb's long-lasting friendship. Under the threat of a civil suit, however, Cobb ended up paying Collins $75. Regardless of his off-the-field difficulties, Cobb continued to play without let-up, and continued to win the adulation of the crowds at Bennett Park and elsewhere. He had one of his most remarkable games against Boston on July 30th, at home before a fine weekday turnout of 4,500. Besides making three hits in four times up, off 41-year-old Cy Young, who had already won more games than anybody else ever would, Cobb scored from second on Rossman's infield hit, threw out Boston catcher Lou Kreiger on a one-hop liner to right, and even registered a put-out at second base when he took part in a rundown play. At the end of July, he was hitting .334, had appeared in every game so far, and was relying on trainer Harry Tuthill to care for bruises and sores that have often made the boy's limbs and body look mottled. The Tigers, by taking 19 of 25 games on the road earlier that month, had broken out of the pack of contenders, although that proved short-lived. Soon thereafter, Cobb demonstrated that he had already reached a place in his profession where he could do virtually as he pleased. On August 2nd, before a Sunday crowd of 8,638 at Bennett, the Tigers lost to Boston 8-4, with Eddie Sicotti, Cobb's teammate at Augusta in 1905, and a Detroit boy making his debut in his hometown, getting the win. The next morning, Cobb caught a train south to get married. Cobb had arranged his wedding date without consulting anybody in the Detroit management. In the middle of a hot pennant race, with Detroit in first place by only one game over St. Louis, Cobb just left. Huey Jennings, when informed of Cobb's plans a couple of days earlier, could do nothing but acquiesce in what Cobb intended to do, whether or not his manager approved. For Paul Brusk, Cobb's action was just one of those characteristic idiosyncrasies for which the player is noted. But what can you do about it? The player is there with the goods on the diamond. Cobb went to his wedding by way of Royston, where he picked up A.C. Ginn, his uncle, on the Chitwood side from Banks County. Finally pulling into Augusta on the Charleston and Western Carolina Railroad on Thursday morning, August 6th, Cobb and Ginn rushed to a friend's rooming house and hurriedly changed clothes. After a hectic 9-mile, 25-minute automobile trip south to the Lombard Estate, Cobb, Ginn, and the Reverend Thomas Walker of Augusta, who was to perform the ceremony, arrived 1 minute before the wedding was to begin, at high noon. In a ceremony marked by that simplicity which is the keynote of excellence, as the local society news reporter described it, Cobb, age 21, and Charlie Marion Lombard, barely 17, were married in the parlor of the Oaks before about 25 guests. There followed a luncheon, visiting with friends that afternoon, and a wedding banquet that evening at the Hotel Genesta in Augusta. Shortly before midnight, they boarded their Pullman car to begin the long journey back to Detroit and the pennant race. Cobb and his bride missed their connection the next day in Cincinnati and finally got into Detroit late Saturday afternoon. On Sunday the 9th, when he came onto the field at Bennett Park, the applause of 8,000 Detroiters showed that they held no hard feelings about his having left the team. He struck out his first time up, but then singled, tripled, and stole a base in the 5-2 win over Washington, with Ed Summers, the Tigers' knuckleballing rookie left-hander, picking up another victory. Meanwhile, Charlie Lombard Cobb sat in the grandstand, surrounded by rooters straining for a good look at their favorite's bride. Those who got close enough saw a rather pretty, dark-haired young woman, already a bit plump, and destined to get considerably more so, but with piercing hazel eyes that were her most attractive feature. If she was taken aback by the swarm of staring people, she must have suspected that it was something she'd have to get used to. When the Tigers left Detroit on August 13th to begin another Eastern tour, Charlie Cobb went with her husband and saw the sights in the great cities Cobb had toured by himself in previous years. At Washington, he got Jennings' consent to pass up an exhibition game scheduled at Newark, so he and Charlie could remain an extra day in the capital. But if the trip east served well as a honeymoon, it was not such a pleasant trip for the ball club, which went into a slump that could have been disastrous had not the other Western teams also played poorly in the east. Cobb did little of consequence on the trip and lost about 20 points on his batting average. Sporting Life's weekly league notes offered a bit of delicate sexual innuendo, to the effect that since his marriage, Cobb had been striking out more than he ever had, and not running the bases with his customary zeal. Subsequently, Jennings declared that never again would he permit a player to marry in mid-season. Early in September, the Tigers torpedoed the Browns' pennant hopes. After two straight losses at St. Louis, Donovan outlasted Waddell 6-4 in front of 26,652, a record-breaking horde that jammed itself around the playing field and onto the grandstand roof and the fence tops at Sportsman's Park. Cobb, besides getting three hits, ended the game by darting into the crowd to take Roy Hartzell's long fly. The teams then went to Detroit, where the Tigers swept a morning-afternoon Labor Day doubleheader before a combined attendance of nearly 29,000. The team got a lift in mid-September when diminutive Owen Doni Bush, a slick-fielding shortstop, came up from Indianapolis to take over from Charlie O'Leary. Bush had as much fire as Cobb, was a lot easier to get along with, and quickly stabilized an infield that had been shaky all season. He would remain as the Tigers' regular shortstop for the next 12 years. When Heine Wagner's homer beat the Tigers at Bennett on September 21st, Detroit dropped from first place for the first time in more than 2 months. Larry Lajoie's Cleveland club went into the lead, with Detroit and Chicago right behind. The Tigers regained the top less than a week later, when Donovan and then Killian beat Philadelphia. On October 2nd, when Detroit came from behind to beat the Browns 7-6 at Bennett, with Cobb scoring the winning run on Rossman's double, the White Sox's Ed Walsh struck out 15 at Cleveland, but lost 1-0, because Addie Joss threw a perfect game. The heroics of the big spitballer, however, kept Chicago in contention. The next day, he came right back to beat the Naps 3-2. And after Doc White outpitched Killian at Chicago on Sunday, October 4th, Walsh then beat the Tigers 6-1 on Monday, thereby completing his third game in 4 days and winning his second. It was Walsh's 40th victory in 1908. Meanwhile, Bill Dineen of St. Louis beat Cleveland, so that at day's end, Detroit led by half a game over both the White Sox and Naps, with one game to play. Doc White tried to win it for Chicago the next day, but was cuffed around by the Tigers in the early innings and gave way to Walsh, who finally had a bad day of his own and left in favor of Frank Smith. Benefiting from 5 White Sox errors, Detroit ran up a 7-0 lead. More than 27,000 sitters and standees at Southside Park watched morosely as Donovan held their worthies to two hits and no runs. Although his hitting had been inconsistent over the last part of the season, Cobb was up to the challenge this day, tripling in two runs in the first inning, later singling twice and driving in another run, and harassing Walsh into a wild pickoff throw past first that scored Crawford. Crawford himself had three singles and a double. McIntyre had three hits and scored three times. Cleveland, by beating St. Louis, finished in second place, half a game behind Detroit, and one game ahead of Chicago. It was the closest three-team race in Major League history. The Tigers won because they ended up playing only 153 of their games, while Cleveland played its full 154. Rules, later adopted in both leagues, would have required the Tigers to make up their missing game, and if they lost and thereby finished tied with Cleveland, forced a playoff. In 1908, though, there was no such provision. Neither the Cleveland management, Ben Johnson, nor anybody else could alter the race's freakish ending. Several thousand people, led by Mayor William B. Thompson, met the Tigers at the Michigan Central Station in Detroit. Following speeches and brass band renditions, the players got into a line of automobiles, and trailed by the band and the crowd, went to the Pontchartrain, where a jubilee was held in the lobby. Thompson and Detroit's other civic boosters could be proud that the city had finally shown big league attendance figures to go with its championship team. That year, 436,199 had paid to get into Bennett Park, a total topped only at Chicago and St. Louis. Frank Navin obviously had a money-making enterprise on his hands. Cobb's statistics were less impressive than in 1907, but then the same could be said of most hitters in both leagues. More than ever, 1908 was a pitcher's year, with American League moundsmen holding the opposition to an average of 2.38 runs per nine innings, and their National League counterparts recording an all-time low aggregate ERA of 2.34. Francis C. Richter, editor of Sporting Life and of the authoritative annual American League Guide, was so alarmed by the batting decline that he advocated prohibiting the use of gloves by outfielders, in the belief that the gloves in use enabled the various dub to face a cannon shot. At 324, Cobb still hit well enough to win his second batting title in a row. He knocked in 101 runs, the only American leaguer to pass the 100 mark, and also led in hits with 188. But he was well down the list in runs scored, 88, and bases stolen, 39. In fact, it was Matty McIntyre, having his best year in the majors thus far, who led in runs, with Crawford and Schaefer behind him. Crawford topped the league with only 7 home runs. The Tiger pitching load was a little more evenly distributed than in 1907. Donovan, hampered by chronic rheumatism, 119. Mullen, considerably less effective than he had been in recent years, was 16-14. And Edgar Willett and Ed Killian won 15 and 12, respectively. Ed Summers, a tall left-hander up from Indianapolis, where he had developed an effective knuckleball, led the staff with a 24-12 record and a brilliant 1.64 ERA. Instead of running away from everybody else in the National League, as they had in the preceding 2 years, the Chicago Cubs were forced into a one-game playoff for the championship with John McGraw's New York Giants. The playoff came about because 2 weeks earlier, Giant rookie Fred Merkle had committed a legendary blunder in failing to touch second base as he ran from first, while a base hit scored what should have been the winning run against the Cubs. In the mob scene that followed, at the old wooden polo grounds, the umpires finally ruled the game a tie. When the two teams ended the season with identical records, a one-game playoff was necessary. On October 7th at New York, Mordecai Brown, who had lost part of his right index finger in a boyhood accident and thereby gained the nickname Three Finger, broke his curve off that finger with sufficient expertise to beat the Giants' great Christy Mathewson 4-2 and send the Cubs into the World Series for the third straight year. The Chicago team arrived in Detroit 2 days later and checked in at the Hotel Tuller to await the start of the series at Bennett Park on Saturday afternoon, October 10th. Manager Frank Chance could hardly even whisper as a consequence of having been struck in the throat by a Giants partisan at the end of the game in New York. Yet if the Tigers were no more weary than the they were about to find that they were still overmatched. About 11,000 showed up for the opening game, far fewer than were needed to fill the temporary bleachers Navin had had erected around the outfield. At the same time, he had ordered the rigging of huge sheets of canvas front of the thicket of wildcat bleachers that had burgeoned outside the left field fence toward the end of the season. The canvas flapped violently in the wind and light rain that marred the game. The dreary weather might have been an omen for the whole series. Leading 6-5 going into the ninth inning, Summers, who had relieved Killian in the third, gave up 6 consecutive singles and lost it 10-6. Cobb had a good day, singling over Harry Steinfeld's head at third to drive in McIntyre with the Tigers' first run, singling again in the seventh, and subsequently scoring on an infield out, reaching first on a bunt in the eighth, when Chance dropped catcher Kling's throw, and then coming all the way home on Rossman's hit and Solly Hoffman's bad throw from center field past Steinfeld. That run, the Cubs again rallied late, breaking a scoreless tie with 6 runs in the eighth off Donovan for a 6-1 victory. With his wife watching, Cobb had only one hit, a single in the ninth, to drive in Detroit's only run. Then on Monday, the Tigers finally won one from the Cubs, knocking around Jake Feaster for 8 runs in as many innings at Chicago, while Mullen held the Cubs to 3. It was Cobb's best outing in a World Series. He had 3 singles and a double, and 2 runs batted in 5 at-bats. In the top of the ninth, with the Tigers well ahead and following his 4th hit, he took his lead off Ed Rulbach, yelled into Johnny Kling that he was going on the next pitch, and proceeded to do just that, knocking over Joe Tinker as he slid in safely. Then he yelled to everybody that he was going to third and stole that base as Kling threw low. When Rossman drew a walk and in a well-tried Tiger maneuver rounded first and started trotting toward second, Cobb bolted for home, only to be caught off base by Rulbach's throw and tagged out by third baseman Stein. Cobb's only public complaint that spring had to do with his brother's baseball fortunes. The St. Louis Browns had drafted Paul Cobb from Joplin after the 1908 season, but manager Jimmy McAleer never notified him to report for spring training. Ty Cobb thought his brother hadn't been treated fairly by the Browns, although there was nothing he could do about it but advise Paul to stay at Royston and wait. That spring was as close as Paul Cobb ever got to the major leagues. Released by the Browns, he caught on with an Eastern League team. For the next 7 years, he bounced from one minor league to another, finally quitting baseball in 1916 to re-enter Georgia Tech. After serving in the Army during the First World War, he eventually went into the real estate business in Florida. When the Tigers got to Dallas early in April for a couple of exhibition dates with the local Texas leaguers, Ty Cobb found another reason for playing extra hard against the Browns. Over the winter, Boston had sold 13-year veteran Lou Kreiger, a good catcher but a puny hitter, to St. Louis, at the same time that Cy Young, Kreiger's longtime battery mate, went to Cleveland. Just as the Browns left Dallas, their spring training site, and the Tigers came in, the local newspapers quoted Kreiger as bragging that Cobb had never given him much trouble and that, "I've got his goat, and I've got the rest of that Tiger bunch too." Kreiger went on to say that in past seasons, when Cobb got up after dodging close pitches called by Kreiger, the fight was all out of him. Before Kreiger could get out of Dallas, Cobb hunted him up to promise that he would steal on Kreiger the first time he got on base against the Browns that year. That he did,
when the Browns came into Bennett Park on April 30th. It would make a good story if Cobb had actually run wild on Kreiger every time Detroit and St. Louis met for the rest of the season, as Cobb later claimed in his autobiography. Yet besides Cobb's confusion in chronology, so that he had Kreiger in 1909, still catching Cy Young for Boston, the fact is that Kreiger generally held his own against Cobb and the rest of the Tigers, on the few occasions when he played against Detroit that year. Cobb never successively stole second, third, and home on Kreiger, as he maintained. On May 1st, he did clearly show up the veteran catcher by taking second after hitting into a fielder's choice, as Kreiger held the ball at home plate. And toward the end of the season, he stole second and third in succession on Kreiger. But on June 24th, Kreiger pegged him out twice in a row. And later that day, Kreiger took Cobb's spikes on his unguarded shins to tag out the Georgian as he tried to score from third on a grounder to shortstop Bobby Wallace. Kreiger stamped the pain off, stuck a gauze pad on his wound, and stayed in. That particular game, which the Tigers won 2-1, with Mullen outpitching Bill Dineen, pushed Detroit's record to 38-19. Sparked by Crawford's robust hitting, by the flashy play of Bush at shortstop, and by the steady work of George Moriarty, a new third baseman obtained from New York, who specialized in stealing home, the Tigers had surged into a 5.5 game lead over Philadelphia. Cobb's hitting was lackluster for the first few weeks of the season. At one point, he was in such a bad slump that he bought a new automobile, an elegant Owen touring car, to help take his mind off his troubles at bat. But as he always did, he soon began to hit profusely. By early June, he was well above 300, and adding to his average with almost every game. If not yet satisfied with his own performance, which he never completely was, Cobb at least now claimed to be content in his relations with his manager and teammates. In an interview in May with the St. Louis Sports Writer, he praised Huey Jennings as a wonder, who had overcome the Tigers' cliqueism, largely through the strategy of assigning feuding players to adjoining hotel rooms on road trips, so that, especially in sharing bathroom facilities, they had to learn to get along. To that same end, Jennings had made certain players take opposite Pullman berths. In such fashion, Jennings had created a situation wherein all the boys are working like one big family. In the same interview, Cobb denounced as an injustice and infamous charges made by various players and writers around the league that he intentionally tried to spike people. He had cut a few men, he admitted, most recently Cleveland's Bill Bradley, his teenage hero, whom he had spiked getting back to third on a pickoff attempt. Catcher Nig Clark had wanted to fight him over that spiking, but Bradley had said, as Cobb quoted him, "Ty, old boy, it wasn't your fault." "Put me right, Bo," Cobb demanded of the press. "I don't mind the bleachers roasting me, but put me right, will you?" While he was no man's friend on the ball field, after the game is over, it's different. Of course, Cobb held plenty of grudges when he left the playing field. He freely accepted challenges from other players, such as Kreiger's, and every day seemed to be challenging himself, striving to show everybody how good he could possibly be. Usually, he succeeded in what he tried. But like all players, both stars and journeymen, he had his embarrassments. Maybe the worst such occasion was May 11, 1909, when more than 10,000 nearly filled the stands at Bennett Park for the ceremonies accompanying the hoisting of last year's American League pennant. The Tigers battered New York that day 16-5, with Cobb doubling twice, driving in two runs, and making it safely home from second on one of Rossman's expert bunts. In the seventh inning, though, he started home from second again on Rossman's roller to the pitcher, ran right past Crawford at third, and, as an amused Hal Chase just held the ball at first and watched, crossed home plate, and was called out for passing another runner. After several moments of bewildered silence, the Detroit fans gave Cobb the kind of razzing he had never heard at home. The next day, though, he more than atoned for his blunder. Playing with the Fury in another lopsided victory over New York, he singled three times and tripled to drive in 3 runs. He also scored twice, one time by stealing second, continuing to third on catcher Kleinoff's wild throw, and coming home when shortstop Jimmy Austin retrieved the ball and threw past Kid Elberfeld at third. If Cobb had any lingering doubts about his already being a famous man, they should have been banished on the Tigers' second trip into Washington in mid-June. Edwin Denby, U.S. representative from the Detroit district, escorted the team to visit first Joseph G. Cannon, the aging autocratic speaker of the House of Representatives, and then over to the White House to meet President William Howard Taft. Cannon knew little about baseball or particular ball players, but Taft ebulliently greeted each Tiger and showed considerable knowledge of the game, and particularly the sorry fortunes of the Washington team. Grasping Cobb's hand and alluding to his own fondness for playing golf at Augusta, the president said, "I believe you and I are fellow citizens of Augusta, Mr. Cobb." The born and bred Georgia Democrat replied that he was glad to be Taft's fellow Augustan, and the Republican chief executive joked, "The only difference is that down there, they think you're a bigger man than I am." A dramatist might have drawn the scene more appropriately with Cobb meeting Theodore Roosevelt, the strong-willed exponent of the strenuous, red-blooded life, rather than Roosevelt's obese, easygoing successor. Yet Cobb and Taft hit it off quite well. Over the next few years, they would occasionally play golf together at Augusta and become rather well acquainted. Cobb's hitting picked up still more in July, when the Tigers found themselves increasingly pressed, not only by Connie Mack's athletics, but by a resurgent Boston team sparked by Tris Speaker, the marvelous rookie center fielder. In the second game of a rain-splattered doubleheader at Washington, Cobb had his first 2-home-run game, slashing one of Charlie Smith's pitches past Jack Lelevelt in right field for one, and later lifting a drive to deepest center field and coming around through Jennings' hold-up sign to barely beat the throw home. The day after that, however, Cobb went hitless in an 18-inning scoreless tie, with Summers going the distance for Detroit, and thereby, many baseball men felt later, ruining his pitching arm. By striking out with the bases loaded to end the 15th inning, Cobb embarrassed the afternoon Detroit Journal, which had just published an extra edition proclaiming Detroit the winner on Cobb's base hit. Cobb's overall play almost justified such blind faith. On July 22nd, at Bennett Park, he again achieved a personal first. After driving in Bush with a single off Boston's Harry Walter, he proceeded to outrun catcher Pat Donahue's throws to second and third, and after McIntyre walked, to come home on a double steal, beating second baseman Ambie McConnell's throw back to Donahue. Hampered by Donovan's sore shoulder, Mullins' fatigue, after he had won his first 12 starts, Crawford's game leg, Cobb's stone-bruised foot, and an assortment of injuries to McIntyre, the Tigers on August 14th yielded first place to the Athletics, the first time they'd been out of the lead all season. Meanwhile, Jennings, thoroughly dissatisfied with his infield, had undertaken to rebuild it at the same time that he tried to keep his team in contention for a third straight pennant. First, the Tiger manager traded the popular but badly slumping Schaefer to tail-end Washington for Jim Delahanty, a good hitter, a capable second baseman, and one of 5 Delahanty brothers to play in the majors. After experimenting with Moriarty at first base, Jennings then put him back on third and dealt the wild-throwing and chronically discontented Rossman to St. Louis for Tom Jones, a solid veteran who was not much at bat but a steady infielder. The play of the newcomers was not spectacular, but at least the infield of Tom Jones, Delahanty, Bush, and Moriarty reduced the errors on a team that had been second in the league in miscues the previous year. Late in August, the Athletics came into Bennett Park for a 3-game series, leading the Tigers by 1 game. The opener provided the occasion for one of the biggest controversies in which Cobb was ever involved. "One thing," he said more than 50 years later, "that's always stuck in my craw." It was a strange game for Cobb from the outset. In the bottom of the first, he coaxed a walk from Harry Krause, Mack's fine rookie left-hander, after taking a pitch while Davy Jones was thrown out at third, an apparent mix-up in signs. Cobb promptly stole second on catcher Paddy Livingston. As Crawford was taking a fourth ball, Cobb unaccountably took off for third. Livingston's throw to third baseman Frank Baker had him easily. When Cobb hook slid to his left, Baker reached over the bag and tagged him with the ball in his bare hand. Cobb's right foot grazed Baker's forearm and opened a small cut. Baker and the rest of the Athletics stormed around the umpires. There were now two for each game, claiming that Cobb should be ejected for deliberately spiking the third baseman. Less than mortally wounded, Baker had a bandage wrapped around his arm and remained in the game. Cobb stoked his foe's ire later in the game when he doubled in a run and upset Eddie Collins, Philadelphia's outstanding young second baseman, as he slid in. Another run scored while Collins tried to regain his bearings. When it was over, the Tigers had won 7-6 to tie for the lead. The next day, Donovan beat Eddie Plank 4-3 before another big weekday crowd, with Cobb getting two hits and a run batted in. On the 26th, Detroit made it a sweep, Mullen shutting out the Athletics 6-0 for his 22nd win. Crawford and Cobb, having switched places in the batting order, with Crawford now in cleanup, each had two hits. And Cobb again bedeviled Collins, this time scoring when he drew the second baseman's wild throw home. In the aftermath of the Baker's spiking, Connie Mack lost his composure for one of the few times in his life. Calling Cobb the dirtiest player in baseball history, he threatened to take up the issue of Cobb's tactics with the American League owners. President Van Johnson, exhibiting his frequent impetuosity, warned that Cobb must stop this sort of playing, or he will have to quit the game. The next day, though, Johnson backtracked, acknowledging that if Cobb had violated any rules at Detroit, the umpires would have handled the matter then and there. Still later, after examining a photograph by William Kunzel of the Detroit News that showed Baker to be off the base and reaching across to tag Cobb, Johnson announced that Cobb had been within his rights on the play. Meanwhile, spokesmen in Detroit leaped to Cobb's defense. Joe S. Jackson of the Free Press suggested that soft-fleshed darlings like Baker should follow the rugged example of Kid Elberfeld, who blocked his base, took the spikes, and grinned and bore his pain. Jennings called Mack a squealer, although he admitted that Cobb was a bit overzealous at times. Even infielder Bob Unglob of Washington spoke up for the Georgian, who, according to Unglob, went only for the bag. "He's playing his style of game," added Unglob. "He goes at everything in the same manner, and he hates to lose." The Tigers won 15 of 16 games on the same home stand during which they swept the Athletics. Cobb, as was so often the case throughout his long career, seemed to derive energy from adversity and criticism. He hit 640 on the home stand and averaged a stolen base per game. By the time the Tigers left for Cleveland on September 2nd, they had built leads of 5 games over Philadelphia and 7.5 over Boston. The Cobb-Baker affair was still boiling when Cobb got into a more serious escapade in Cleveland. On Friday night, September 3rd, after a rain-terminated tie at League Park, Cobb went to the theater with some of his teammates. Afterward, he had supper with Vaughn Glazer, the play's producer-director, whom he had met a year or so earlier in Detroit. When Cobb returned to the Hotel Euclid at 2 o'clock and started up to his room, he got into an argument with the black elevator operator, whom he later described as insolent. Apparently, Cobb slapped the man, at which point George Stansfield, the hotel's black night watchman, intervened. Cobb and Stansfield began shouting at each other, and Stansfield struck Cobb with his nightstick. They struggled and fell to the floor, where Cobb managed to get a knife from his pocket and slashed at Stansfield. The watchman threw Cobb off, made it to his feet, pulled his pistol, and knocked Cobb to his knees with another blow from the nightstick. Other hotel employees then came between the two. Holding his head, Cobb finally made his way to his room. The next afternoon, Cleveland's Cy Falkenberg and Cy Young beat Mullen and Donovan in a doubleheader to cut the Tigers' lead to 3 games. Cobb showed up with head and cheek bandaged, got 3 hits off Falkenberg, but was held hitless by the venerable Young. Meanwhile, the manager of the Euclid finally got around to notifying the police about the previous night's disturbance. By the time 2 detectives arrived at League Park to talk to Cobb, the second game was over, and he and the rest of the team were already at Union Depot, about to board their train for St. Louis. Although the Detroit papers played down the Cleveland fracas, the press elsewhere carried fairly extensive reports. The New York Age, a black weekly, recalled last year's run-in with a black street worker in Detroit and commented that Cobb had once more come into the limelight for ruffianism. A couple of days after the fight, Stansfield, reportedly suffering from head, shoulder, and hand wounds, and too weak to leave his bed, had his attorney swear out a warrant for Cobb's arrest on a charge of cutting with intent to kill. At the same time, Stansfield filed a civil suit against Cobb for $5,000 in damages. The word from Cleveland was that a detective would soon be coming to Detroit to serve the arrest warrant. Frank Navin and the ball club's attorneys quickly started working to extricate Cobb from the Cleveland imbroglio. Over long distance, Navin talked Stansfield's employers at the Hotel Euclid into getting him to drop the criminal charges against Cobb. Meanwhile, Edward S. Burke, the club's legal representative, came to Cleveland, had a conference with Stansfield and his lawyers, and arranged a settlement whereby the club agreed to pay Stansfield's medical expenses plus an amount of cash, described by Jake Mintz, the Cleveland detective in charge of the case, as a pitiful sum, so small I would be ashamed to tell you. Even though Stansfield had dropped his charges, Mintz added, the Cleveland police intended to pursue the warrant on their own. Whenever Cobb crossed into Ohio, Mintz intended to lay for his train and drag him off. It will cost him a pretty penny to fight the case. It was bad enough to be facing arrest in Cleveland without having to worry about being shot down by a murderous Philadelphian. Yet that was exactly what was threatened in a dozen notes Cobb had received by the time the Tigers came into Philadelphia on September 15th, leading the Athletics by 4 games, to start a climactic 4-game series. Kept going, largely by the vitriolic columns of the Bulletin's Horace Vogel, anti-Cobb feeling still ran high over the Baker spiking the previous month. When Eddie Plank took the mound on Thursday afternoon, the 16th, an overflow crowd of 24,710 had jammed into the Athletics' new ballpark, occupied since the beginning of that season. Named after club president Benjamin Scheib and located at 22nd Street and Lehigh Avenue, it was the first of its kind, an all-steel and concrete structure intended to maximize customer comfort and convenience. Not part of the paying crowd at Scheib Park that day were hundreds of policemen who surrounded the Tiger bench, roamed the stands and park environs, and most of all, hovered behind a jittery Cobb in right field. As it happened, the only serious work they had to do was keep Danny Murphy and Davy Jones from coming to blows after they exchanged insults near the Tigers' dugout before the game. At one point, Cobb jumped about 2 feet off the ground when a motor car backfired outside the park. Otherwise, nothing of note took place except good baseball, with Plank outpitching Summers 2-1. Cobb went hitless in 4 times up, and perhaps understandably distracted, struck out with the bases loaded in the 4th inning. That evening, Cobb left the Hotel Aldine for his customary after-dinner walk and cigar, only to be confronted by a crowd of surly Philadelphians who looked about ready to lynch him. Like the heroes in the Western dime novels of those years, he walked right into the crowd, which parted mutteringly and let him go on his way. The next day, his concentration and fervor back to normal, Cobb had 2 bunt singles and a sacrifice fly off Harry Krause. Scoring late, the Tigers won it 5-3 for Mullen and restored their 4-game margin. When Cobb stole 3rd, Baker shook his hand to signify that bygones were bygones. The crowd cheered Cobb when he dived into the roped-off area in the right field corner to take Harry Davis's foul fly. and again, when he returned next inning with $5 for a man whose straw hat he had crushed in making the catch. And when the game ended, a number of Athletics rooters shook his hand and clapped him on the back. On Saturday and Monday, first Charles Chief Bender, and then again Eddie Plank, shut down the Tiger batters 2-0 and 4-3. The Saturday crowd was everywhere, even massed atop the concrete outfield walls and on the roofs of row houses outside the park. The Philadelphia management claimed that 35,000 saw the game, the biggest gathering in baseball history. Another huge turnout on Monday pushed the four-game attendance close to 120,000. On both days, the Philadelphia partisans continued to cheer Cobb, even though he spiked shortstop Jack Berry going into second early in Monday's game. As he left the field to get his leg stitched up, Berry gestured to the fans to indicate that the spiking had been accidental. Almost as if he missed the crowd's hostility, Cobb managed only a single on Saturday and another on Monday. Although they won only 1-4 at Philadelphia, Cobb and company left town still 2 games up. The two teams battled evenly for the next week. Then on September 29th, the Tigers clinched a tie for the pennant with a doubleheader victory over Boston, mainly on the heroics of Killian, who went the distance in both games, and Cobb, who had 5 hits in 7 at-bats. Detroit backed into a third straight league championship at Boston the next day. Although Mullen failed in a bid for his 30th win, Chicago's Jim Scott and Bill Burns beat the Athletics in a doubleheader to put Detroit up by 4 games with only 3 to play. Jennings then sent Cobb and 7 other mainstays back to Detroit to rest up. 3 days later, the Detroit substitutes ended the season by beating Chicago for the team's 98th win, the most in American League history up to then. The Athletics finished 3.5 games behind. With 3 singles and a double in his last appearance of the regular season, Detroit's next-to-last game, Cobb finished with an average of .377, 31 points higher than runner-up Eddie Collins. With the title went a huge Silver Loving Cup, given to the top batter in the major leagues by George Honey Boy Evans, a well-known songwriter and blackface comedian of the period. Cobb also led the league in hits, 216, runs, 116, stolen bases, 76, runs batted in, 107, home runs, 9, and total bases, 296. No American leaguer had ever stolen that many times. Only once had any player stolen as many in the major leagues. It was the finest all-around year anybody had enjoyed up to then. In the National League that year, the mighty Cubs won 104 games. But the Pittsburgh Pirates, led by their great shortstop, John Honus Wagner, were even mightier, ending with a 110-42 record. In mid-season, the Pirates had moved into the second of the steel and concrete parks that, over the next several years, would replace the old wooden facilities in the major league cities. Later named Forbes Field, the Pittsburgh park seated just short of 30,000, with standing room for several thousand more in a big outfield. It, Scheib Park, and Chicago's Comiskey Park, where the White Sox would debut in 1910, were the original showplaces of the early 20th century baseball boom. The World Series got underway in the Pittsburgh park on October 7th. Cobb arrived by an out-of-the-way route. While the rest of the team came through Cleveland on the Lakeshore Railroad, he and his wife traveled across Ontario to Buffalo, and then south to Pittsburgh on the Michigan Central and Pennsylvania lines, so that Cobb could avoid being arrested in Cleveland, where the authorities had secured an indictment for felonious assault in the Stansfield matter. For the rest of his series travels, Cobb had to continue to bypass Ohio. Before Game 1, there was as much betting on how Cobb and Wagner would do comparatively as there was on the outcome of the series itself. While the Pirates took batting practice and Cobb talked near the Tiger dugout with his wife and his mother, who had come up from Georgia for the series, the stocky, amazingly bow-legged Wagner came over and introduced himself. a primitive motion picture camera recorded Cobb and the popular Dutchman, who had just led his league in batting for the seventh time, as they chatted amiably, discovered that they used similar hands-apart sliding grips on the bat, and agreed that Wagner would join Cobb for some bird hunting in Georgia during the off-season. Wagner then proceeded to outperform Cobb in almost every category. Although the Tigers put up their best fight so far in a World Series, taking player-manager Fred Clark's Pirates the full seven games, Cobb's showing was almost as disappointing as in 1907. In the seven games, he was only 6 for 26, an average of 231. Half of his hits, though, were doubles. He also stole two bases. One of those steals came in Game 1, when just under 30,000 watched right-hander Charles Babe Adams, in his first full year in the majors, beat Mullen 4-1. Cobb walked and scored the Tigers' only run in the first inning, and later got on via a fielder's choice, and Hook slid safely into second as Wagner one-handedly fielded catcher George Gibson's low throw and made a swooping tag. In the seventh, little Tommy Leach made a running catch of Cobb's drive in deep right center with two Tigers on base to end the last Detroit threat. The next day, a couple of thousand more people saw the Tigers pound Howie Kamnitz and Vic Willis for seven runs, while Donovan held the Pirates to two. After walking in the third inning and taking third when Jim Delahanty drove home Davy Jones and Bush, Cobb had his biggest moment of the series. As Willis went into his windmill windup for his first pitch, Cobb dashed home and slid by Gibson for a clean steal. Later, he grounded a single over second. The two teams combined for 20 hits in Game 3, played before Detroit's biggest series crowd thus far, 18,277. Nick Maddox survived six Tiger runs. Summers, Willett, and Ralph Works yielded eight to Pittsburgh. Cobb singled in Davy Jones in a four-run seventh inning, made a tumbling catch of John Dots Miller's liner in the sixth, and in the bottom of that inning, doubled into the overflow in right to send in Davy Jones again in a two-run rally that fell short. Cobb had only one hit in each of the next two games. With the Detroit temperatures in the low 30s, Mullen tossed a four-hit shutout in the fourth game, besting Al Lefty Leafield and Charles Deacon Philippe 5-0. Cobb's double in the third brought home Davy Jones and Bush, but twice Gibson grabbed his bunts and threw him out. Back in Pittsburgh on October 12th, Adams allowed the Tigers six hits, including three by Crawford and a homer by Jones, while the Pirates knocked Summers around for an 8-4 victory to take the series lead. Cobb's offensive contribution was a line single in the sixth, followed by Crawford's run-scoring double. In Game 6, only 10,535 chilled fans were on hand in Detroit to see Mullen scatter eight hits and even the series in a thrilling 5-4 game. Tom Jones had to leave after a collision with Bill Abstein at first, and Schmidt and Moriarty were spiked, tagging out runners to kill the Pirates' rally in the ninth. Cobb's liner past Abstein, which rolled into the crowd for a double to score Davy Jones in the sixth, was his only hit. One of 10 the Tigers got off Willis, Kamnitz, and Philippe. Adams' six-hit shutout at Detroit on Saturday the 16th sent the Tigers to another World Series defeat. Donovan left after three innings and two runs that resulted mainly from his wildness. Mullen, with little left after winning 29 regular season games and going the distance in his two series starts, yielded the remaining six runs. Adams got Cobb to fly out twice and tap back to him in his other two times up. In better weather, 17,562 disappointed fans sat in the Bennett Park stands and stood around the outfield. The crowds at the seven games set a new series attendance record and put $1,273.50 in each Tiger's pocket. That, and the fact that they had pushed the Pirates to the limit, provided some consolation for a unique three straight series defeats. Again, Detroit's catchers, this time Schmidt and Oscar Stanage, had been unable to stop National League base runners. Pittsburgh stole 14 bases, with Wagner alone taking 6, to go with his .333 series batting average. Weak catching, the inability to hit at critical times, and the unheralded, unanticipated pitching prowess of Babe Adams, who had only 12 wins during the season, pretty much decided the outcome. Celebrational banquets following Tiger World Series defeats were becoming rather monotonous. Nonetheless, some 250 well-to-do Detroiters turned out at the Pontchartrain to cheer the three-time losers. The banqueters made up a collection of $64 for Ulysses Harrison, a diminutive young black man whom the team had taken on in mid-season as its bat boy, or mascot, to use the term then current. Designated custodian of Harrison's purse, Cobb paternally promised to take the man, inevitably nicknamed Rastus, back south with him and give him a job around an Augusta automobile dealership Cobb had bought. There was still that messy business in Cleveland to tend to. On October 20th, Cobb, accompanied by Frank Navin and attorneys Burke and R.E. McKisson, former mayor of Cleveland, appeared in Common Pleas Court and pleaded not guilty to the indictment for felonious assault on George Stansfield. Trial was set for November, with Cobb released under a $500 bond. Back in Detroit, Cobb put his wife on a train for Augusta and prepared to leave for New York. He was scheduled to drive an expensive Chalmers 30 in another Good Roads promotional trip, this one terminating at Augusta. Before he left town, Navin arranged for him to come by the Bennett Park office and, for the benefit of the press, smile agreeably, sign a blank contract, shake hands with Navin, and then catch his train, ostensibly happy to trust his boss to do right by him. Actually, they had come to terms well before the signing tableau, and with surprising amiability. Navin could afford to be generous. That year, his team had pulled close to 500,000 people into the cramped Detroit ballpark. Only the Athletics and Highlanders, both located in huge metropolitan areas, had drawn more in the American League. The uncertain Detroit franchise of a few years earlier had turned into one of the most profitable in baseball. So Navin was willing to settle with Cobb for a 3-year contract at $9,000 per year. Only Honus Wagner, a 13-year veteran who had been a top star long before Cobb began playing pro ball, would be making more money in 1910. After the drive south from New York, an excursion again accompanied by receptions and speech-making, Cobb spent a few days around Royston and in Augusta getting his dealership launched. Then it was back to Cleveland, where Navin's attorneys had plea bargained the charge against Cobb down to assault and battery. On November 22nd, Cobb pleaded guilty to the lesser charge and was fined $100 and costs. When he said he didn't have that much money with him, the judge let him leave the court with a promise to pay the fine on the Tigers' first visit to Cleveland during the 1910 season. Well married, famous, on his way to being rich, and with his legal troubles cleared up, Cobb could smile plenty for photographers now. He doubtless looked forward to appearing in more World Series. As things turned out, though, the 1909 team was the last pennant winner he would ever play on. For the next 19 years, he would be a member of also-rans. Only once during that long span would he come really close to another series. Yet in those years, he would amass the most remarkable set of individual statistics in the history of the game. And he would remain a singular personality, frequently surrounded by the acrimony and strife that seemed necessary byproducts of his vying nature. 6. The greatest player of all time. While Cobb spent most of the off-season near his wife, who was expecting their first child, Matty McIntyre led a patched-together group of Tigers to Cuba for a series with two local teams. A year earlier, the Cincinnati Reds had dropped the majority of the games they had played in Cuba. And with a squad that lacked not only Cobb, but Crawford, Donovan, Summers, and Delahanty, and soon would lose Bush because of an injury, McIntyre should have expected a tough time. Of the 12 games played against the all-Cuban Almendares team and the Havana Reds, who had added several outstanding black professionals from the United States, the Detroit aggregation won only 4. Clearly, the best Cuban baseball was already comparable to the best played by Los Gringos, although for decades North American commentators, even those who saw firsthand how good the Cubans were, continued to downgrade the caliber of play in that country and other parts of Hispanic America. Meanwhile, Cobb threw himself into both recreation and business affairs with the same zeal that he typically brought to the baseball field. At the posh new Augusta Country Club, he tried golf, immediately liked the game, and began to play it resolutely. That November, he had a short visit with President Taft, down for a little winter golfing at Augusta himself, who called Cobb the most popular Georgian, and had him pose for the photographers with Major Archie Butt, Taft's military aide and a native Georgian. Cobb also did a fair amount of off-season hunting, especially on George Stallings' property near Haddocks in central Georgia, where Honus Wagner also dropped in for some bird shooting in January. Stallings, an Augusta native, had managed Philadelphia in the old 12-team National League, guided Detroit in 1901, the first season in which the American League had operated on a par with the National, and then managed in the minors until Frank Farrell hired him to lead the New York American Leaguers, whom he had brought in fifth in 1909. Dark-featured, hot-tempered, known for outbursts of stunning profanity on the bench, Stallings had done well outside baseball. Stallings' place was what Northern writers often mistakenly termed the Cobb Farm at Royston, an authentic plantation, a 4,000-acre domain on which as many as 50 black people produced cotton. Cobb's business ventures took up most of his time that winter. His automobile dealership in Augusta evidently got off to a good start. Ulysses Harrison, the team mascot to whom Cobb had given a job, returned to Detroit early in February with a report that in his first month, Cobb had sold about 10 motor cars. On attractive land at Toccoa in Habersham County, not far from his birthplace, Cobb and his business partners built another group of dwellings for black renters, similar to what they had already done at Hazelhurst in the southern part of the state. As Cobb had sketched the plan the previous spring to a St. Louis sports writer, this nigger property down home, dubbed Booker T. Washington Heights, consisted of a dozen houses constructed at a cost of $200 each and renting for $2 to $3.50 a week. There's money in it, Cobb was convinced. Tyrus Raymond Cobb, Jr. was born on January 30th at The Oaks, the Lombard estate south of Augusta. New right fielder, Cobb wired the Detroit sports editors. 9-pound boy. Everybody well and happy. By the time the baby was 10 weeks old, his father was bragging that he was a left-handed hitter, had the biggest chest development of any baby in the country, and could already support himself on his own legs if held upright. Frank Navin congratulated friend Cobb on his son's arrival and extended his wishes that the young man will prove to be as good a man as his father. He added that he had received a bill for $1,200 from the Cleveland law firm that had represented Cobb in the Stansfield case. I promised you I would see you through in the matter, wrote Navin, and therefore I paid the same without any parley. He hoped that it will prove a good lesson to you. Cobb doubtless had that particular favor in mind when, in a letter to the Detroit papers late in March, he declared that Navin has shown me he is my friend, and our relations could not be better. Frank Navin congratulated friend Cobb on his son's arrival and extended his wishes that the young man will prove to be as good a man as his father. He added that he had received a bill for $1,200 from the Cleveland law firm that had represented Cobb in the Stansfield case. I promised you I would see you through in the matter, wrote Navin, and therefore I paid the same without any parley. He hoped that it will prove a good lesson to you. Cobb doubtless had that particular favor in mind when, in a letter to the Detroit papers late in March, he declared that Navin has shown me he is my friend and our relations could not be better. By that time, Cobb was engaged in his usual procrastination about going to spring training, which in 1910 was again far away at San Antonio. At his dealership, he looked up from fixing something on one of his motor cars and told reporters that his only reason for not being at San Antonio was these four autos you see on the floor. He had to get back his $4,000 investment and couldn't see why he should pass up a chance to make this extra money just for the sake of going clear to Texas for training. Besides, he had been working out daily with the local Sally League team and sometimes playing against the Boston National Leaguers, also training at Augusta. Navid wanted him to join the team by April 1st, in justice to the club. The club president and everybody else realized that Cobb's presence would make substantial difference in the exhibition game receipts, on which the club depended to help pay spring training costs. Still, Cobb delayed. The fact was that he despised just about everything having to do with spring training. From the cheap hotels and unpredictable food, to the monotony of morning afternoon workouts, to the rattling train trips to out-of-the-way places for games on skinned and potholed ball fields. Unlike others on his team, Cobb had no close pals whom he looked forward to seeing again after a winter separation. It was just a dull, lonely routine, and a totally unnecessary one for a man who prided himself on always staying in shape. So year after year, while Navin, Huey Jennings, and his teammates grumbled about his absences, Cobb took advantage of his star status and stayed away as long as possible. That spring of 1910, though, he did work unusually hard off the field, so much so that thereafter he left the running of the automobile dealership to others before eventually selling out. Looking tired and run down, he finally left Augusta on April 3rd. After stopping off at Royston to visit his mother and sister, he joined the Tiger regulars at Evansville, Indiana, in time for an exhibition game. Although Cobb hardly needed to be told that he was a top star, such reassurances now came from all quarters, and in superlatives hitherto not even applied to Lajoie or Wagner. The previous fall, for example, Jimmy McAleer, moving from managership of the St. Louis Browns over to the Washington team for 1910, hailed Cobb as the wonder of the baseball world and the greatest piece of baseball machinery that ever stepped on the diamond. Yet while McAleer's praise was nice, more attention-getting was what Charles Comiskey, owner of the Chicago White Sox, said in a nationally syndicated newspaper piece that spring. After 40 years in the game as player, manager, and club executive, Comiskey spoke authoritatively in baseball circles. Thus, when the old Roman pronounced Cobb the greatest player of all time, it seemed an especially significant accolade. Cobb, said Comiskey, plays ball with his whole anatomy, his head, his arms, his hands, his legs, his feet. Dedicated and hard-driving, Cobb was also exceptionally intelligent, able to recognize and overcome his own weaknesses, as well as exploit those of others. Above all, Cobb was a student, willing to learn something new about baseball every day of his life. Cobb had yet to mature as a man. Some might say he never did. By the start of his fifth major league season, however, he had brought his skills as a ball player to a state of maturity that might be termed the essential Cobb. He had already reached that stage in his career when he could do everything on the ball field he would ever be able to do, and with greater aggregate talents than anybody who had come before him. The Cobb of the years 1910 through 17 was the Cobb baseball fans would remember most vividly in the decades after his retirement. Cobb's style and temperament were sufficiently dominant in those years that historians would describe pre-World War I baseball as the Cobbian game, as opposed to the Ruthian game that came to prevail after the war. By 1910, Cobb knew the American League inside out. He knew what kind of stuff the established pitchers threw, knew what they would probably throw in given situations, knew how well or how poorly they held runners on base. He hit nearly all of them at least passingly well. Right-handers like Ed Walsh, Cy Young, Walter Johnson, Addie Joss. Lefties like Eddie Plank, Doc White, the towering Cy Falkenberg. Cobb also knew the catchers, what kind of arms they had, when they would likely call for a pitch out. And he knew just as well the outfielders' arms, how quickly they fielded base hits, and thus, when he could go for an extra base on them. Game after game, play after play, Cobb scrutinized the opposition, seeking some new insight into a man's actions on the field, some idiosyncrasy or minor shortcoming he could capitalize on. If not that day, then sometime. As he swung three bats waiting to hit, Cobb would work himself into a state approaching hatred for the pitcher he was about to face. If they watched closely enough, spectators sitting near the field could see him clenching his jaws and gritting his teeth. When he got to the plate, he might try almost anything to upset the pitcher, including defiant exchanges, even with such an august personage as Cy Young. He might take his stance, then suddenly jump backward out of the batter's box, or bend over and reach down for a handful of dirt, even as the pitcher delivered the ball, seemingly unmindful of the pitch. On one occasion in 1917, he stood at the plate with his back turned to Eddie Cicotti, talking to Sam Crawford on deck, while the flustered Cicotti threw four straight balls. In 1913, Walter Johnson remarked that he could never seem to get a strike by Cobb because he just nips at the ball. Cobb often hit the ball a long way, but even more, he often slapped, poked, or bunted it. Besides bunting to get on base, a skill at which nobody surpassed him, Cobb, playing in an era when even the most feared hitters were expected to give themselves up to move runners along, was also usually up near the leaders in sacrifice bunts. Although he bunted successfully on every infielder, he always claimed that third baseman George Buck Weaver of the White Sox was the hardest man to lay one down on. Like all hitters, Cobb had his slumps. Bunting for hits was one way he worked his way through such periods. He would also take extra batting practice, not trying to hit the ball for distance, but just right through the middle of the infield. In that way, he soon regained his timing and began to connect as usual. Cobb claimed that it was easier to pull out of a slump playing away from home, because I like opposition, and I can get myself straightened out with a crowd hooting me for failing to hit. At any rate, never in 23 full seasons in the American League did he have a prolonged batting drought. Once on base, particularly after a hard sprint, Cobb sometimes held his leg and limped around in an effort to fool the other team into thinking he had hurt himself and would have trouble running. Typically, he kicked the bag forward to get the advantage of a couple of inches of play in the strap that held it down. When he took his lead, he would lunge ahead on false starts, wave his arms, yell at the pitcher, and otherwise do everything possible to upset the opposition. While such actions might seem bush league in a later, more sedate time in baseball history, for Cobb, they repeatedly proved effective. Going into a base, Cobb had little regard for the well-being of infielder or catcher. Most of the time, though, he did not ram straight into the base, but executed a graceful hook slide, either touching the bag with his toe or grabbing it with his hand as he went by. Either way, he left little for a baseman to tag. If opponents still got spiked, as they often did, then that was just too bad as far as Cobb was concerned. Over and over, he argued that the base runner has the right of way, and the man who blocks it does it at his own peril. In general, Cobb viewed the baseball field as an arena of harsh, unrelenting combat, where he had to meet trick with trick. "I have observed," he said in 1914, "that baseball is not unlike a war." A decade later, he was still insisting that it is just as sportsmanlike to make the other fellow tremble as to let him make me tremble. Opponents early came to understand that it was in their own best interest not to rile Cobb unnecessarily. The one thing we didn't want to do was get him mad, recalled Ray Schalk, the scrappy little man who became first string catcher for the White Sox in 1913, and remained so for the next 13 years. So when Cobb came on the field, players on the other team would call out, "Hello, Peach. How are you, Peach?" and otherwise behave affably. Cobb had no use for the idea that once the contest seems safely won, it is inadvisable to embarrass or humiliate the opposition. In his thinking, there was always a good, practical reason for pouring it on, even after his team got way ahead. As he put it in 1921, "If we cannot only beat them, but run wild on them in addition, treat them like a lot of bush leaguers, it is liable to put them up in the air for a week." What Cobb sought, as both player and later as manager, was to work a general demoralization on the opposition. Yet for a man who studied everything about the game so closely, worked to refine his every move, took such a scientific approach to baseball, that it seemed to one observer he had been spending his off-season in the company of intellectuals, Cobb was a remarkably superstitious person. Besides the usual quirks about horseshoes, rabbit's feet, black cats, and the like, he exhibited several idiosyncratic fetishes. During the cake-cutting ceremony at his wedding, for example, he held a black bat that he had used in winning the batting championship the previous year. Cobb still carried that bat around with him, even though he never hit with it after 1907. When he was in a hitting surge and playing at home, he followed an obsessive daily routine, which included eating the same food, taking the same route to the ballpark, putting on the same uniform sock first, and wearing the same sweatshirt, no matter how rank it got. As long as his hot streak continued, he refused to allow his uniform to be cleaned, even though it was usually the dirtiest on the team. After making four hits in a game in 1909, he became furious with trainer Harry Tuthill for moving his shower towel to a different peg from the one on which Cobb had been hanging it. Such blind beliefs were part of Cobb's complex makeup as he began the 1910 season, one that, as usual, would be peppered with controversy. It was a flush time for baseball. Some 25,000 swamped Little Hilltop Park in Manhattan, at 168th Street and Broadway, when the Yankees, as people had started calling the New York American Leaguers, opened with the Boston team, now nicknamed the Red Sox. At Washington, a record crowd of 12,226 watched William Howard Taft throw out the first ball and thereby establish a presidential custom. At Bennett Park, where another Navin-directed renovation had added about 3,000 seats, the crowd still overflowed to see Addie Joss and George Mullen both stagger the route in a 9-7 Cleveland win. A week later, the two teams opened Cleveland's home season before about 18,000 in League Park, enlarged and partly rebuilt in steel and concrete during the off-season. Earlier in the year, Ohio's governor had signed a bill making Sunday baseball legal everywhere in that state. Michigan's Sabbatarian restrictions remained on the statute books, but state and local authorities continued to ignore the Sunday games now regularly scheduled at Bennett Park. The Tigers looked as strong as ever early in the season. Manager Jennings finally settled on Davy Jones for his regular left fielder, and with Crawford bothered by a sore leg, shifted him to right and put Cobb in center. With the two men in their natural positions for the first time in 3 years, the Tiger outfield was at maximum defensive effectiveness. Even when McIntyre replaced Jones from time to time, Cobb stayed in center. Despite Donovan's worsening rheumatism, which kept him from taking the mound until late May, the pitching held up pretty well around Mullen, Willett, and Summers. For the first 2 months of the season, the Tigers battled for the league lead with Connie Mack's Athletics and a revived New York team, directed by Cobb's friend George Stallings. A three-game sweep of the Athletics, followed by 3 wins in 4 games against New York, highlighted that period. Late in June, however, the tail-end St. Louis Browns blunted the Tigers' pennant hopes by taking 4 of 6 games at Detroit. And not long after that, the Athletics swept a 4-game series at Philadelphia and virtually killed their chances. By mid-July, the Tigers trailed the accelerating Athletics by 10 games. For all practical purposes, the race was over. With sturdy pitching from Jack Combs, who won 30 that year, Eddie Plank, Chief Bender, and Cy Morgan. Sparkling infield play from Eddie Collins, Jack Berry, and Frank Baker. And solid hitting from outfielders Danny Murphy and Rube Oldring. Connie Mack's team ended up 14.5 games in front of second place New York, and 18 ahead of Detroit. Cobb always thought the 1910-11 Athletics were the best team he ever saw. Not only in terms of talent, but because, boy, they were smart. On July 9th, Cobb was hitting .372, the best average he had shown at mid-season. Yet he was still 27 points behind Napoleon Lajoie. The muscular, swarthily handsome Cleveland second baseman, now freed from managerial burdens, was having his best season since 1901, when his .422 set a standard unequaled in either major league for 23 years. A new Chalmers 30, donated by Hugh Chalmers, president of the automobile company that bore his name, awaited the year's top hitter in the majors. Although such a prize would excite few people today, the modest financial rewards available to most players in 1910, along with the glamour that had attached to the Chalmers 30, lent unprecedented drama to the batting competition that year. The prospect of not winning a fourth straight title, and also missing out on the Chalmers, may have begun to wear on Cobb's nerves a bit. He seemed sulky and petulant during the disastrous July series at Philadelphia. For one game, he did not get to Shibe Park until the third inning, and generally played below par. At the end of the month, however, he performed with his customary fire in a 4-game sweep at Chicago. The finale, on Sunday, July 31st, inaugurated the White Sox new ballpark. 6-year-old James T. Farrell saw that game and never forgot Cobb's home run off Ed Walsh in the fifth inning, a liner that bounced through an iron gate in the left field corner. Following a bases-loaded homer to the same spot by Chicago's Lee Tannehill the previous inning, Cobb's drive made the difference in a 6-5 victory. Back at Detroit for a homestand, Cobb turned problem child again. Since late the previous season, he and some of his teammates, particularly Donnie Bush and Davy Jones, had occasionally bickered over missed signs. At bat, Cobb would flash his own bunt and hit-and-run signals. Base runners were supposed to watch him, not Jennings, to find out what to do. On August 2nd, in the midst of a ninth-inning rally against Boston, he and Jones got mixed up in a hit-and-run situation. Cobb looked at Ed Carger's pitch as Jones took off and was thrown out by Bill Kerrigan. That ended the rally and sent the Tigers to another defeat. Afterward, Cobb and Jones quarreled in the clubhouse. Following an off day, Cobb refused to suit up for the series finale, grumbling that he wouldn't play again until Jennings took Jones out of the lineup. He watched from the grandstand as Willett defeated Carger 4-2, with McIntyre taking his place in center field. When New York came into Bennett Park the next day, Cobb arrived at the clubhouse after everybody else had suited up and started to get into uniform, only to be told by Harry Tuthill that Jennings had said he needn't bother. Again, he sat in the stands, as according to one report, his teammates chuckled with glee. And again, the Tigers won without him, battering spitballer Russell Ford 9-6. The next day, a Saturday, Cobb had a talk with Navin, acknowledged that he may have been hasty in flaring up at Jones, and announced to Jennings that he was ready to play. This time, Jennings went along with him. And that afternoon, Cobb contributed 2 singles, a sacrifice fly, and a stolen base to Mullins' shutout of New York. To appease Cobb, Jennings agreed to drop Bush from second in the batting order down to sixth, so that he would never be on the bases when Cobb was at the plate. Yet Cobb's dark mood had hardly passed. That same afternoon, the left field Bleacherites and people along the third base foul line rode Cobb from the time he stepped on the field. At one point, he started to climb into the stands after a black spectator who had heckled him throughout the game. Police got there just before he reached the man and managed to herd him back to the Tigers' dugout behind third. Wrote the Detroit Free Press's E.A. Batchelor, "Ty is a Southerner born and bred, and naturally holds ideas of his own regarding the right of a colored man to abuse him in public." Added Frank Navin, "If Cobb were less impetuous, he would be less valuable to the club. He is a youngster, hardly more than a boy, and comes from a section of the country where pride is strong." The discord on the ball club continued for the remainder of the season. Davy Jones charged that Cobb was more concerned with winning the batting championship again than he was with the team's welfare, and that he often failed to follow through on his own signals if a pitch wasn't to his liking. Jones seemed to have a point, both about Cobb's refusal to swing at questionable pitches with teammates in jeopardy, and also the whole matter of individual versus team play. An exploit at Philadelphia later in August, for example, would have been almost unthinkable on a disciplined ball club like McGraw's Giants or Mack's Athletics. With the Tigers down 7-0 in the ninth inning, Cobb hit a high bounder back of second, kept going around first, and beat Jack Berry's throw to Eddie Collins. When George Moriarty's liner off pitcher Combs's glove caromed over to Collins, and when Collins then threw to first for the sure out, Cobb shot around third and barely beat Harry Davis's throw from first to home plate. It was all quite sensational, even breathtaking, but also foolhardy and bound to feed his teammates' resentments. It turned out to be futile as well, because Combs then retired Bush to end the game. Such cavortings delighted the crowds, though, as did the tight American League batting race. By the first part of September, LeJoie had tailed off to 372 and led Cobb by only 8 points. At that juncture, Cobb began to have trouble with his vision and stayed in Detroit when the Tigers went to Cleveland for 4 games. When the two teams returned to Bennett Park, Cobb was in the grandstand wearing smoked glasses. Although examination by an ophthalmologist, or oculist as such physicians were then called, showed that Cobb was nearsighted in his right eye, the problem turned out to be an inflammation of the optic nerves in the other eye. The ailment was real enough, but Cleveland sports writers, still angry about Cobb's spiking of Bill Bradley the previous year, derided him for not going head-to-head against LeJoie. His eye trouble cleared up. Cobb was back in the lineup by September 20th. Playing at home before his wife and 8-month-old son Ty Jr., who had come up from Augusta in August, he was awarded a homer in the opener of a doubleheader with Washington when his line drive rolled under the turnstile gate in right center. He passed LeJoie with 5-for-6 in 2 games against New York, where Hal Chase's Machiavellian intrigues had got Stallings fired in favor of Chase. After going 4-for-7 on October 6th through 7th at Chicago, Cobb, confident that he held a safe lead, passed up the final 2 games there and left in his automobile for Philadelphia, where the Athletics were to play a series of tune-up games with a team of selected American leaguers while they waited out another week before the National League season ended. Cobb, scoffed the Cleveland Plain Dealer, was suffering from that peculiar disease, congealed condition of the pedal extremities, known to card players as cold feet. To catch Cobb, LeJoie needed a hit nearly every time he came up in a season-closing doubleheader at St. Louis on Sunday, October 9th. At the end of that bizarre day, he had 8 hits in 9 times at bat, and according to most unofficial calculations, had edged Cobb for the batting championship. What happened was that the Browns, or at least most of them, out of their hatred for Cobb and their liking for the good-dispositioned LeJoie, undertook to fix it so the Frenchman would win the Chalmers. Before the game, Browns manager Jack O'Connor instructed John Red Corridan, a young third baseman who had come up toward the end of the season, to play on the outfield grass behind third to avoid injury from one of LeJoie's vicious line drives. The gullible rookie did just that, all day long. In his first time up, Lajoie clouted a legitimate triple over the head of Hub Northern, another rookie in center field. The next time at bat, though, he bunted toward shortstop Bobby Wallace, who fielded the ball slowly and threw too late to get Lajoie. And the time after that, he bunted to third, where Corydon was so far back that he had no chance for a play. From then on, Lajoie bunted to Corydon six more times. On all but one, a fielder's choice, he made easy base hits, so that he ended with 8 for 9. Determined that Lajoie should have a perfect day, Brown's coach, Harry Howell, first went to the press section to inquire about the scoring on the fielder's choice, and then sent over the bat boy with a note offering scorer E.V. Parrish a suit of clothes if he changed his ruling. Parrish refused. At the end of the second game, won incidentally by Cleveland to give the teams a split, many of the 10,000 or so St. Louis fans on hand poured onto the field to congratulate the popular Frenchman. The odor hanging over Sportsman's Park was foul indeed. The next day, when all 5 St. Louis sports writers at the scene charged the Browns with giving Lajoie hits, O'Connor lamely answered that Lajoie outguessed us. We figured he did not have the nerve to bunt every time after tripling. Said Lajoie, dissatisfied because he'd been scored only 8 for 9, "I fooled them right along." Red Corydon could only plead, "I wasn't going to get killed playing in on Lajoie." That afternoon, Lajoie received a congratulatory telegram from 8 of Cobb's teammates. Ban Johnson's handling of the Smelly affair was masterfully politic. After he and Gary Herman, National Commission chairman, both issued announcements that there would be no more prizes awarded for batting leadership alone, Johnson had Robert McRoy, his secretary and keeper of the American League's official statistics, hurriedly calculate the season averages. On October 15th, less than a week after the St. Louis fiasco, Johnson declared Cobb the battling titleist, with an average of 384.944, to Lajoie's 384.084, at the same time that he affirmed the legitimacy of Lajoie's 8-hit day. "I am simply delighted, delighted, delighted," enthused Cobb in Philadelphia when he heard the news. Maintaining that the competition with Lajoie was of a most friendly character, he tactfully refused to say anything critical about the St. Louis games. He was just glad everything has turned out as it did, and tickled to death. Shortly thereafter, Hugh Chalmers, coupling generosity with promotional acumen, announced that his company would give a Chalmers 30 to Cobb and to Lajoie, too. That was done at the opening game of the World Series between the Athletics and Cubs at Shibe Park. Meanwhile, owner Robert Lee Hedges of the Browns fired both O'Connell and Howell. Ban Johnson used his vast influence to ensure that neither man found a job with a team in organized baseball, although Howell eventually did some umpiring in the minors. Of the whole affair, St. Louis Post-Dispatch sports writer John E. Ray wrote, "It's a soiled page. Let's turn it over for good." Playing with such stars as Tris Speaker, Clyde Millan, Walter Johnson, and Ed Walsh, in 3 of the 5 tune-up games with the Athletics, Cobb earned several hundred dollars out of the All-Stars share of the gate receipts, plus a gold watch and diamond stick pin given by the Philadelphia club to each of the players. He stayed over in Philadelphia for the first 2 games of the series to make a little more money, providing his observations to the Detroit Free Press. Cobb then passed up the rest of the series, and with his wife and infant son, embarked on an arduous journey from Philadelphia to Augusta in the new Chalmers. Before he left, though, he, along with Jennings, Crawford, Donovan, and several others, heard that the investment of their 19-9 series money in a copper mining venture at Bisbee, Arizona, had just paid off lavishly. The stock they had bought at $3 a share was now worth $1,000 a share. Cobb had also put about $1,000 into cotton futures on the Tigers' last trip into New York. Now he sold for a profit of $7,500. Along about that time, moreover, he bought a big block of stock in United Motors, soon to be absorbed into General Motors, at a few dollars a share. Cobb had spent years listening and learning in the heady atmosphere of the Hotel Pontchartrain Bar and other favorite gathering places for Detroit's business elite, but he had lacked the capital to follow up on the tips that came his way. Now, having money to invest and a growing number of informative business acquaintances, especially in the burgeoning auto industry, Cobb began to accumulate the stock that would constitute the major portion of his fortune. If Cobb's financial circumstances improved steadily, his relations with teammates were at their lowest point since the spring of 1907. Cobb was on the outs, not only with Davy Jones, Bush, and again McIntyre, but now as well with Crawford, who had come to Bush's defense when Cobb criticized the little shortstop's play. Shortly before the end of the season, Crawford publicly complained that the trouble with the Tigers in 1910 had been too much Cobb. Jennings, Crawford said, let Cobb do about as he pleased. That included not only skipping morning practices and sometimes showing up late for games, but also playing mainly for his own statistics. Paul Brusk agreed that time made his season a personal one. With his star now on speaking terms with only a few of the other Tigers, Huey Jennings has a problem to solve before next season rolls around. Within baseball circles that fall, rumors circulated frequently that Cobb would be traded. While Cobb traveled about in his new Chalmers and tried some auto racing at the Atlanta and Savannah Speedways, Frank Navin maintained that the effect of the alleged dissension on the team had been exaggerated. So long as I retain any connection with the Detroit Baseball Club, he added, Ty Cobb will play in this city. Regardless of how the other players felt, Navin was not about to trade a man who had just topped the league's hitters for the fourth straight year, led in runs and in slugging average, come in second in homers, runs batted in, hits and stolen bases, and become the outstanding gate attraction in baseball. Early in November, the alarming news reached Navin that Cobb intended to drive against Nap Rucker, his old Augusta roommate and now a mainstay of Brooklyn's pitching staff, in a 10-mile match race at the Atlanta track. The Tiger president hurriedly got off a wire to Cobb, urging him not to go through with the dangerous stunt. Although the match had been heavily promoted in the Atlanta area, Cobb finally heeded Navin's plea and backed out. For three or four more years, though, auto racing would rank with golf and hunting among Cobb's favorite off-season diversions. What finally scared him off racing, he later said, was the fatal crash of the professional racer Bill McNay at Savannah, only a few days after he and Cobb had hit 105 miles per hour in a test drive on that course. Also in November 1910, George Mullen led a contingent of Tigers to Cuba for a second series of games with Almendares and the Havana Reds. Billy Evans went along to do the umpiring. Unlike the makeshift group McIntyre had brought down in 1909, Mullen's team included Crawford and all the Tiger starting pitchers, and Cobb had promised to join the team later. Again, catcher Bruce Petway and infielders Pete Hill, Grant Johnson, and John Henry Lloyd, sometimes called the Black Lajoie, who had all played that summer for the powerful Leland Giants of Chicago, were on hand to bolster the Havana team. And again, Almendares consisted entirely of native Cubans, or as Brusk termed them, dusky representatives of the Fertile Isle. Lacking enthusiasm for the Cuban venture, Cobb came only because there was money in it. The Tigers won three, lost three, and tied one against the Cuban teams by the time his boat arrived from Key West on November 26th. The next day, before some 15,000 swarming aficionados at the Havana Stadium, he debuted with two singles and a home run against pitcher Munoz of Almendares, as Mullen shut out the Cubans 4-0. 2 days later, Gonzalez of Havana did the same thing to the Tigers and Willett, 3-0. Cobb went hitless and walked once. When he tried to steal on Petway, The black catcher got the ball to second so quickly that shortstop Lloyd was waiting for Cobb and deftly tagged him out while sidestepping his spikes. The Tigers perked up considerably after Cobb joined them and finished with a 7-4-1 record. In the last game against Almendares, they beat right-hander Jose Mendez, a slender, fireballing 23-year-old black Cuban who had thrown a shutout early in the series and then battled Summers to a 10-inning tie. Already something of a national idol and well-known in North American black baseball as a consequence of a 1909 tour with the Cuban All-Stars, Mendez added to his reputation by holding Cobb to a single and striking him out once, even though the rest of the Tigers hit him well enough to win 6-3. In the five games he played in Cuba, Cobb had 7 hits at 19 at-bats for a 3.70 average. Crawford hit 3.60 in 12 games. In their 6 games against the Tigers, Lloyd hit 500, Johnson 412, and Pettway 390, all against frontline major league pitching. Cobb's competitive instincts should have caused him to speculate on how he would fare season after season against such talent as he had encountered in Cuba, if black ball players were ever allowed in his league. Yet according to various accounts, Cobb vowed never again to take the field against blacks. At any rate, he never did. In 1911, Detroit was to train at Monroe, Louisiana. Cobb was no more anxious to get there than he had been to get to San Antonio the preceding 2 years. Navin again plaintively pressed him to report with the rest of the players, as your failure to do so creates a feeling on the club, which was brought out in the papers last year. If Cobb got to Monroe on time, tried to achieve harmony on the team, and helped Jennings every way he could, then I will show you in a very substantial way my appreciation of your efforts. In mid-March, Cobb reported to Jennings at New Orleans, in time for an exhibition game. At least this spring, he would not have to contend with Matty McIntyre, who had been sold to the White Sox over the winter. At New Orleans and back at Monroe, Cobb impressed reporters as being slowed down a great deal. One even suggested that while he might become a more powerful hitter, he would never regain his past speed. Unhappy with the Spartan accommodations at Monroe, and estranged from nearly everybody except the rookies, Cobb got Jennings' consent to train by himself at French Lick, Indiana, a popular resort in the southern part of the state. When he rejoined the club at Evansville a week or so later, he was his usual self on the bases and in the outfield. The startled newsman with the team discovered that when they had seen him in Louisiana, he had been working out with lead weights in his shoes to strengthen his calves and ankles. By that time, Cobb and Davy Jones had smoothed over their differences. When Paul Brusk wrote that Cobb was willing to eat humble pie in his feud with Crawford, Navin upbraided Brusk for saying something that will put him, Cobb, right back on edge again. "You know Cobb's disposition as well as I do, and that when he reads an article like that, he is up in the air." At Indianapolis, Navin sought to make peace between Cobb and Crawford and Bush. Bush agreed to try to get along with Cobb, but Crawford refused to be reconciled. Finally, after further diplomacy by Navin, Jennings, and team captain George Moriarty, the two outfielders shook hands on the eve of another season. They would never come to like each other, though. So despite the snow flurries that chilled about 5,500 fans on opening day at Bennett, the sun supposedly was shining brightly on Detroit baseball once again. Cobb homered into the left field bleachers his second time up in that game, off Ed Walsh, and the Tigers went on to win 4-2. They won 11 more in a row, the greatest start any team had made in Major League history. With Cobb and Crawford both pounding the ball, and with Del Gaynor, a rookie first baseman up from the Central League, hitting around 350 and fielding his position expertly, the Tigers went on to win 31 of their first 40 games and open up a 9.5 game lead over the Athletics. They were still playing at a 700 clip in mid-July, despite the loss of Gaynor, whose wrist was broken by a Jack Combs pitch in his 26th game. In a season that produced big jumps in scoring and individual and team batting averages in both leagues, and much discussion of the apparently livelier cork-centered ball introduced that year, Cobb's play was frequently awe-inspiring. After he scored from first base on Crawford's single, dashed home from second on a wild pitch, and doubled in two runs at New York, Sporting Life estimated his value to his club at $100,000.